put the microphone on, now they can hear us live over the Buseys. Again, I did this once before, and it was pretty cool.
But they shouldn't hear us yet.
They can hear us.
Well, when does it make it start the thing start? Then we'll be fine.
Oh, I can hit the next button.
Yeah.
Should I do that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
What?
The last time you did it like this, Brian said terrible things, and then I got a message from John because he got a message from a listener.
What?
Yeah. It's not a big deal.
What did Brian say?
We say offensive stuff all the time.
Was it a while ago or was it recently?
Like maybe 10 episodes ago. So not super recent.
It's
but
just
not...
weird that it went to him.
Yeah, well, because he's in charge of Muse.
Oh, so...
So somebody's like,
well,
hey.
I mean, was he in charge of Muse? I mean, he's just kind of a figurehead. I mean,
that's a valid point.
I mean, I don't... I just think...
The person thought he was the person to contact. I mean, it's like sending a letter to Santa.
Sure. That's probably as effective as sending a letter to Damaris.
Yes.
They're very similar people.
They're both French.
Yeah, I can't keep track of. If people find things we say offensive, they can take a fork and shove it in their butt.
Yep.
That's
and not just like stab a cheek. Like they need to get the fork into the butt.
Yeah, you got to maneuver it. I don't know. Just
difficult.
Randomly.
Yeah.
I mean,
it's
actually
gonna catch.
You can do either side too. You can.
Whichever. No, tine first.
Yeah, whichever you want to do.
I guess that's easier to come out.
Well, yeah. I mean, either way, there's going to be a challenge at some point.
Fair.
I mean, yeah. People are sensitive.
They are.
They just don't understand. We're trying to make America great again.
I started a Facebook fight after work today, apparently. Did. I didn't think I thought I was saying something fairly innocuous, but...
You did. Hey, you gave me an excuse to post in all bolds for a while.
Travis, you can hear us.
Is Travis... Is that live or from earlier? Travis,
no, that's live.
Oh.
It's always live.
Update information.
I used to chat with Travis every morning at work. We chat like every day for years, and then I had to do work at work, and now I don't chat with anybody.
If you want to chat with Travis every day, start a convention with him.
I mean, he usually responds. It's just I haven't sent him a message in like 7 months because my job has been like busy for like 2 years.
Well, flip side, he won't leave me alone.
Yeah.
I've been asking is like, do you guys want me to run solo masters for you guys? Yeah. And then basically, most of the time, the answer I got back is like, do you?
You've asked me 3 times, and I've said sure every time.
Yeah. I mean,
sure,
whatever.
I mean, you know, I don't know.
I'm not going to do well in Solo Masters, so I'm gonna run it, and I'm going to choose my favorite, and that person will win.
There you go.
That's not how it works. I mean, I guess it can be. If you're the one running it, I can't stop you.
You could stop me.
You can do whatever you want.
Yeah.
You could stop me.
Things could happen.
Hey, welcome to episode 190 of the Crippled System Podcast.
The Crippled System Podcast. Not the Crippled Systems.
Wow, so there
cripples.
Is...
The Cripples Podcast.
When you do a search...
Can I say Cripples?
On Privateer's website for Hollow
Man. Everyone but Brian is looking at the phones. I don't have a phone in my pocket. I'm moving my arms instead.
It shows a lot of things in there.
What shows a lot of things in
when
what?
You search for Hollow Man on Privateer's store,
yeah.
It actually, unless it was just taking the word man,
it was probably just taking the word man.
Yeah.
No, I'm sure it was.
Search for SmogCon.
I just search for Hollow.
You could search for Hollow as well, but all other models are Hollow.
Aww.
So
there it is.
They had some SmogCon announcements. Are those announcements SmogCon?
Yeah, well, that'd be good. Two good topics. Did we intro? What episode is this?
190. Oh, my God.
190.
Yeah.
I came prepared to podcast, and you two are retarded.
No. What?
Hey, do you want to guess what was the offensive thing that was talked about?
Retards. They're funny.
Yeah.
We just watched a great episode. I introduced Jackie. She came over earlier. We were talking about her Kickstarter book, because I'm doing artwork for it, which is kind of cool.
I just held back a terrible comment for the record.
She had never seen Always Sunny as well, so I started showing. Jeff was over watching Always Sunny with us, so she got to see the last two episodes of it, so she got to see the hero or Hate Crime, which is a great episode of Always Sunny. And then I thought, it was like, you know, what's a really good classic Always Sunny episode of the show? One is Dee is dating a retarded person.
Sure.
And that was probably one of my favorite. It still is one of my favorite episodes of Always Sunny.
It's a good one. It's a top five. What's his name? Is a thing too. I can't think of his name. The one guy
who Quimby.
There's Quimby.
Quimby doesn't know anything about Night Court, and it bothers me.
Well, why
would he knows?
Why would a 16-year-old know anything about Night Court?
No. But he did know about Night Court.
I mean, he knows
as in because he watched. No. He watched all of Arrested Development and John Larroquette's on there. They made references to Night Court on Arrested Development. I don't remember this. This must have been through the fourth season.
I don't.
Maybe third. I don't remember.
A couple random episodes,
John Larroquette made references to Night Court on Arrested Development, according to Quimby.
Yes.
See, when you said that John Larroquette made a reference on Arrested Development, I thought, man, I haven't watched it in a long time. I don't believe that's correct, but Andy said it, and you know he probably remembers it. But now that I realize this is coming from Quimby. I just held back another comment. You're welcome. It's two comments Brian's held back today on. I have control today. And I'm rested, so I have a filter, and it's working 1/10 of the time, which is amazing, really.
And Google just saved my life, because I had no way of spelling
Laura Kett. You almost died? Correctly. Thank you, Google.
Well, I almost died from desperately trying to spell Laura Kett. It figured it out for me.
I didn't realize almost misspelling a name would kill you.
You don't have an English teacher for a mother.
Boston Legal. Now, that's a funny show. And I am
IMDb-ing John Laura Kett.
There's a good reference to a random thing.
Just figure out what the hell he is in.
Although I still prefer The Practice, but...
He was in the John Larroquette show.
Yes. You know, if he wasn't,
that would be... The Librarians.
That's a popular show for some reason.
Brink.
The Brink, yeah. That's the show with Jack Black and...
He's in two episodes Tim... of Chuck.
Yes, he is. He plays.
One episode of Park and Rec.
Oh, yeah.
It may be...
33 episodes of Boston Legal. Yeah, so I think non-Euclidean Nick was right.
Quimby might have been talking about Chuck.
No. I'm pretty sure it was probably Boston Legal. I'm pretty sure. You know what? You tell me
I don't think say things about Boston Quimby, Legal.
And then you tell me these things, and it's very hard.
He was the uncredited narrator in the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, The Beginning.
The remake?
One of the remakes.
Yeah. He was in one episode of Arrested Development as himself.
Okay, yeah.
So, like, he probably had a single 5-minute scene, and unless that scene was nothing but Night Court, what probably happened is they went, oh, John Larroquette, you were in Night Court, and that was it.
Yeah.
And that was the thing, it couldn't be like, that was Quimby's favorite spot. So, anyway, we were...
What about John Larroquette?
I don't know.
He was in, oh man, there's a whole bunch of TV movies about a guy named McBride. Let's see. We got McBride, The Chameleon Murder, McBride, Murder Past Midnight, McBride, It's Murder, Madam, McBride, The Doctor Is Out, ... Jesus. Really out.
Where can we get these?
And McBride, Tune In for Murder, and McBride, Anybody Here, Murder Marty.
Where are these?
And all of these came out in 2005.
What channel? We need to find this.
Oh, they're TV movies. He's Mike McBride.
Oh my god, this sounds... We need this.
One of them has a 6.6. I clicked one at random. It's a 6.6 out of 10 in IMDb.
Do you know what channel?
What is happening right now?
We're
I'll Google Mike McBride.
We're gushing over John Larroquette.
Well, and we do have two topics to talk about, but they're both War Machine related, so Brian might...
I am prepared for all things today.
Because the two obvious things to talk about are...
The new faction.
SR 2017.
What? And no.
The faction.
Okay, hold on. I'm putting John Larroquette on here because he officially...
Yeah, he deserves...
I've already forgotten to spell his name. I'm going to guess Laura...
I don't know when Kett. We started talking about him, but I'll put the...
That looks like a type of bird, Laura sure. Keep.
Yeah. Mike, oh, you're going to make me try to spell it.
Mike McBride.
And then can we talk about the Hordes faction?
No, there's no.
Do
no
you want to talk faction. About the Hordes faction first?
There's also ATC to talk about.
Yeah,
and Adepticon.
I posted all of the lists.
Don't interrupt the John Larroquette talk.
We're still looking at McBride film series. It's 10 made for TV movies.
Jesus.
Made for the Hallmark Channel.
Oh, you know, the Hallmark Channel. I just read is a huge surge in popularity over the last couple of years. They've been flying up.
Yeah. It was released by the Hallmark Channel between 2005 and 2008. It now appears regularly on the Hallmark Channel. Hmm. While on the Hallmark Channel, it was broadcast in rotation with the movie series Jane Doe, Murder 101, and Mystery Woman under the umbrella title Hallmark Channel Mystery Wheel. Ooh, in the UK, these movies are aired on a rotation basis in an afternoon drama slot on Channel 5.
Hmm.
There are 23 teams for ATC. There were 24, and then one of them kept not submitting their lists, and I had to go like full stalker mode to track this guy down because he wasn't responding to the emails, and he wasn't responding to my Facebook messages because his Facebook page had last been updated like 7 years ago. And so I had to like go on his Facebook page, look on his friends list, and start messaging random people to try to get in contact with him. I felt like a serial killer or stalker or something. But
I call that Tuesday.
Right. But anyway, so his team ended up, it wasn't going to make it. So we have 23 teams. The lists are all posted. They are on www.conflictchamber.com/OctothorpeATClists. And
Octothorpe spelled out Octothorpe.
Yeah, that's the name of that symbol.
Hashtag.
That
looks like
no, the correct name for that symbol is Octothorpe.
Pound.
So
hashtag
Octothorpe.
Pound.
The Octothorpe is that symbol.
Some people ask you, Brian, why do you podcast? My answer is always, I don't know. I really don't know. I was having such a good day at home.
All right. Anyway, look at lists. It's cool. There's some interesting stuff there. I always like looking at people's lists and statistics or whatever.
The ATC list was pretty cool. I did look through the list. It is. That's the fun part of these kind of events is looking at the list and seeing what people are doing, see who's trying to do the same thing. The list part is cool.
Somebody has a Hydra under Makeda 1, and I lost track of how many attacks that thing can make.
4.
15, I think?
Well, I mean, it has
5 initials.
Yeah, buys 4.
Buys 4, so that's 9, and then she jackhammers 6 times.
Yeah.
That thing can make 15 fucking attacks.
Yep. Look out, world. Yeah, it's going to be fun. There were some neat lists. I mean, looking at lists is fun. I like looking at the ATC list or WITC, whatever it is.
ATC.
It's fun. Well, I'm just saying later on.
Whichever, yeah. Even events that aren't ours, like when people post like the Ontario Team Championship ones and stuff like that, it's cool to look at them.
But we could see those too because they're going to be at the same time.
Yeah, yeah. It's a shame. But oh well. Next year it won't be. I was annoyed that the Oshkosh people scheduled an event for that same weekend.
Well, they timed that there was a convention going on, so they wanted to fit into a convention.
It
so
makes
it wasn't,
sense.
It's still a little ridiculous, and they could have just not gone to their crappy con. I mean, let's be fair, an Oshkosh con, it's going to be like shit anyway. I've been to Oshkosh con. Yeah, I mean, it's going to be like a bottom. I think last time it was like a room of a school. And they had, like, you know, 3 guys playing D&D, a guy playing a board game, and then 3 guys playing
just one board. Guy playing a board game by himself.
He's like, I'm winning!
I would have liked it better if one guy playing D&D by himself.
D&D. Yeah.
You know.
Just being the narrator, and then also, like I go here! Alright, well, let's see.
That's how says Oshkosh wishes it was Fond du Lac.
Yeah.
But I guess Fond du Lac doesn't have a chain of overalls based on it.
I would probably say Oshkosh probably wishes that it was Green Bay.
Well, who doesn't?
Yeah.
They all wish they were Appleton.
Except Appleton
wishes they were Green Bay.
They were Whitewater.
This is the most ridiculous referencing. Middle of Wisconsin. Someone's like, what the fuck is going on?
I know these places. One of them was in the Marcy.
Truly, truly, I think they all want to be Sheboygan.
Yeah. Well, who doesn't? I mean, come on. Sheboygan is king of all. Anyway, so that's that. Solo Masters is still available. Come play in the Solo Masters.
Oh, yeah.
Bring Brian's for Andy.
Come
Andy
play with Brian and Solo Masters.
Mm-hmm. You actually going?
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. I have a catering. Sign. And we picked, because not a lot of people be coming from outside of Wisconsin, one of the 2 days the catering is the Lambeau Leap Meal, which is all brats and stuff like that.
So cheese curds?
It's brats and cheese and good stuff.
Mm-hmm. A lot of kraut.
And the other one, I hope so.
I might just come and have kraut. The food.
Right?
Just pay. Do we have to
pay?
Food is included with entry.
Yeah.
Oh, but if I'm running something,
but no food.
I'll probably give you guys some money.
Eh, whatever.
Yeah.
We'll just somebody else won't get to eat.
Okay, that's perfect then.
So you can't. They have to watch you eat.
Ah, Pagani doesn't have to eat.
No. Yeah. Makes sense.
Pagani coming?
Yeah, Pagani's playing. He got permission from Privateer Press to play. Obviously, he can't get the prize, but the winning team is allowed to substitute one of their players and still keep the prize. So if his team wins, they'll just have to boot Pagani and pick another person.
Gotcha.
I'm assuming that's because he was already slated into it before
he got a job. He works for the company now, and if being an employee of Heritage Press shows you one thing, is a quality of skill, how to play the game drops dramatically.
He will lose terribly.
So he probably already forgot. Like
Wimby basic, will beat him.
Yeah,
I will say though, the fact that Privateer is actually letting him play is really cool. I mean, in all of our experiences going to conventions with Privateer players, they usually can't play in a tournament.
Yeah.
They can't play, they have to play with a fully painted army, which makes sense because they want to be representative of the company. It's usually you never see them
play. My guess is...
I've been seeing them more in who's the boss, goofy type things. They've been kind of sneaking in a little bit more.
I think it ties in with your previous point, and I think they just want him to go away because he probably plays with them and crushes their faces in at the office.
They just want one week off.
Yeah, they just
one
want weekend a week away. Without Pagani
beating
them.
Was Plummer or Foster joined, and they did really well and beat up all... They had their little... I think it was Plummer.
Yeah.
Plummer is a great guy. He was never what I would say was good at the game. And he went there.
He had his moments.
He had his moments. He
was all right.
He was all right. That is the nicest thing I'll allow you
to do. He went 3-2 a Madison tournament.
Yeah.
Yeah. But then he went there and was crushing them, and they had their little... That's when they were pulsing their little in-house tournaments. He'd crush them all and just kick their butt, and this is just hilarious.
Well, it's like that one guy whose name I don't remember who was here, and we kept crushing him, and then he moved to California, and they even had to start cheating the system, and he was still winning. He was undefeated, and he was garbage here.
That's back when we were actually good at the game.
Yes, when we were Vikings and we'd invade other cities.
Yeah, we would steal everybody's toys.
The metas around us... Minnesota stopped running events. Tower Games died, right? So they stopped running events.
They're still there.
Meta died.
The actual games. War Machine.
No War Machine. Events. The Milwaukee thing had their implosion where they went from having three press gangers running events to
three separate countries. There's three countries in Milwaukee right now.
And they have one event every 6 months. Madison has 75 press gangers, one event every 4 months.
Yeah.
Chicago does have their once a month event in the second week, but Chicago's the only place consistent around us.
Yeah. And the problem with me is that for some reason that their event always lands on the weekend I have to work, so I can never go to a Chicago event.
Well, half the time it will for sure.
Well, no, it's 11 months out of 12.
Yeah.
Just because the universe hates me.
And honestly, half the Madison crew who would play tournaments just doesn't like to deal with one of their players, so they just don't want to deal with the drama of that. So they just don't. They'd rather not drive 3 hours, deal with drama, and just rather stay home.
Fair.
Yeah.
So it's hard.
I love 95% of the people in Chicago.
I like the game store they play in a lot. It's a very nice game store.
The Dice Dojo?
Dice Dojo is a very kick-ass store.
Even the one that's a little bit north of there, I cannot think of the...
Yeah, the one that's north there, I prefer playing there because it's a half an hour closer.
Yeah.
And it's nice. Fond memories of
that
place.
We even went to DeKalb and played in that event where it was all old league scenarios.
And DeKalb doesn't even do things anymore.
Yeah.
That was Grays Lake.
Oh, that was Grays Lake. That was bizarre.
Yeah.
I know that Billy is running an event.
Cedar Rapids
is Cedar Rapids.
Billy. See, all right then. Thanks, Billy.
But I think they're running it's a 35-point event.
I don't know. It's probably...
Does he know Mark III exists?
he's like...
I think it was...
Yeah, he's like, oh, what the heck?
I think it was Billy's event. I'd have to look at my events on Facebook. But I saw somebody was running a 35-point event. I got invited to it. I'm like, was that a... Were you printing that from last year? You just cut and paste there? He was like, nope, we're running a Rumble style. I'm like, oh, okay.
Could be fun. Whatever. I mean, I don't know that I ever went to an event that was a 25-point game in Mark II, but I know that the concept of playing a small game like that,
Those are usually fun. I have nothing against the games. I will travel, the radius where I will travel is shrinks based on the point size.
Right.
So 75 points is the biggest, farthest bubble I would go, and then as you shrink points, my thing dramatically.
You'll go 2 miles per point.
Something like it. Well, no, because it really... in the old way, 50, 70, if it was in Mark II, 50 I would go, 3 hours for anything under 50, I would go only an hour. So it's
exponential.
It's 75 point would be the thing here.
Just got a message from Jeff.
Basically, so actually, to be fair, Mark III, there is a high chance of 75 point, and anything under 75 points is about a 0 to 1.
Travis posted a sentence that I'm trying to parse. Madison and Milwaukee is running an event in literally 2 weeks from now.
In literally 2 weeks, there's the ATC, but that's...
That's three. Event.
It's three weeks?
3 weeks from yesterday.
Oh, 3 weeks from yesterday.
It's...
Yeah, it's 3 weeks from yesterday is the ATC.
Yeah, but I mean, we...
But so are Madison and Milwaukee running an event?
I think some other judge is running an event from Madison at the ATC.
I'm just saying, back in our heyday, we would have events 10 months of the year in Madison.
Yeah.
Now we have events 3 months out of the year.
Well, because you don't run them anymore. I've been busy with this shit.
Yeah.
And Andy, that leaves Andy and Rick...
And what's his
Paul.
Name?
And Paul. And I've never seen Paul run an event.
Paul supposedly is alive.
He's been on Thursdays over at Misty.
Which is fine. I'm just saying that he's not running events.
I just don't know. I haven't seen him in a long time. I don't know if Paul is even in the War Machine anymore. Like, I mean, that could.
He just posted he was playing it last Thursday.
Oh, yeah. So that's cool. I mean, that's good.
He works until 6 or 7, so it makes it difficult to get for him to come down and play locally.
Okay, someone else says Travis is not wrong. So they're claiming that 13 days from now, so the Saturday before the ATC, there's an event in Madison and an event in Milwaukee. Because he says Madison and Milwaukee, but then there's an is, which is singular, and so I'm confused. But if there's an event in Madison and an event in Milwaukee, both of them the week before the ATC...
I think it's a tier list.
That I saw, but I'm too busy being confused by this... Who's running an event in Madison the week before the ATC? Who's running an event in Milwaukee the week before the ATC?
I don't know. I was basically waiting for later on.
Announcements, there's mystery events that nobody's running the week before the ATC. No, don't tell me I'm wrong, Travis. You're the jackass who said... how am I wrong? I am very wrong... Travis said that in 2 weeks, Madison and Milwaukee... Oh, okay. So he's saying that someone from Madison, i.e. me, and someone from Milwaukee, i.e. him, are running an event together.
No, it's Travis and some other judge from Madison.
Some other judge.
Yeah.
And it's next Thursday.
Oh, wait a second. I need to check my calendar. Is the ATC really two Saturdays from now? Holy fuck.
Suddenly... Yes.
Oh yeah, because today's the 19th. Yeah. Yeah. Holy shit! I forgot that February's all short.
I mean, it's only by three days. Surprise!
I'm gonna eat a gun.
But yeah,
you find out you have to work that weekend.
No. I requested off like a motherfucker.
Yeah. So it's all good. So we have a new faction. We have the Hollow Men.
Okay. Okay. We'll do new faction. Then we'll talk about Steamroller afterwards. Yeah. That way we can be.
So the
write down 22.
22, all right.
The new faction
is Grimkin.
Looks amazing. The video was a little thick in the nonsense. I just had to keep skipping around to get to the date and the pictures.
Hi, everybody! It's the Fang!
I introduced...
I was like, holy crap, someone's on drugs, and it's not the good kind.
If anybody was listening to the Lost Aspect, I introduced the Lost Aspect as the old witch.
When I was talking like this... Did you say Menouth?
I have too many cats. Oh my god, that would be excellent.
Travis is so angry, it's great.
That would be amazing to put the new Scrapjack thing, the big house, just fill it with cats.
Of course. Obviously.
Meow.
Jesus. Yeah, that'll be great for the listeners.
It was like, just the video was so, I mean...
But I'm excited.
The models are fucking amazing.
I like all the models. A lot of people hate the... Well, let's go... Well, whatever.
We can talk about each one individually.
I in no way remember what any of them are named or details.
So the casters. We'll start with the casters.
Which is a lot, actually, isn't it?
There's five of them. Six. There's six, including the Old Witch. So let's actually start with a quick thing about the Old Witch. She does work for Kador and for Grimkin, but they clarified later that she's actually got different card sets.
Oh, so she's got different...
There is Old Witch 2 and Old Witch 3 in that box, one of which works for Grimkin and one of which works for Kador.
Oh.
Before they said that, I was kind of wondering if maybe her spell list would have a lot of things that affect Jax and a lot of different things that affect beasts, mm-hmm. which would functionally make it, but then she'd have to have a focus and a fury, and it would be weird. Or, ultimately, she could have just used beasts in a Kador list, and that could have been a rule, kind of like
yep.
Magnus. Well, yeah. you played Scorn, so it's funny. Yeah. Like Magnus in Mark
yeah.
2.
Yeah, yeah.
But no, so she's going to have two cards. It's Old Witch 2 and Old Witch 3 in a box. So I don't know if it'll be a kit and there'll be like a slightly different model or if
one,
it's just the same
one
model.
Has more cats than the other.
Right. Well, they could have like Grimkin bits versus, you know, yeah. a Widowmaker sitting on top of the house, you know, depending on who she's running. But they probably won't. They'll probably just have different cards. But yeah, so that's exciting. But then there's five actual fluff ones and they showed... Mm-hmm. Three of them.
They went in detail over three of them. There's the last two that they didn't really talk
yeah,
about.
Yeah, there's a little girl with a big thing. Now, was she on the same base as him?
That's I believe so, yeah.
That is the child.
The child. And then there's the Dreamer, and I really like the model for the Dreamer. It's a really cool model. I keep flipping back and forth about the cartoon-looking moons with the faces on them, yeah. like Mac Tonight.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll blink, and I'll think it's beautiful, and I'll blink, and I'll think they look stupid. Mm-hmm. And I haven't quite... decided which I'll permanently be on.
It really, man, depending on the painter, that could really pop, though.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then the other one was the Heretic? Was that the one that...
The Heretic is
the guy like holding his face?
Yep.
And only the Old Witch has an actual feat. They all have abilities that trigger
Arcana
during the
game. Arcana is what they called it.
Yeah. I will say...
If there's two separate cards, though, then she might actually not actually have a feat?
No, it said only one with an actual feat. Okay. That was in the video.
What will be interesting, and one of the, and this by no means is a negative thing, but one thing that will be, I think, will be challenging for that faction is when you play a faction like Krix that relies on souls or things that rely on things, a lot of their factions seem to be when conditions happen. So a lot of times, depending on how easy you can make them happen versus how often you have to rely on your right. opponent's list, it'll be interesting to see which ones are more...
The interesting will be because the way that Arcana work is they have three of them.
Yep.
And each Warlock had one that's set in stone. Like, yep. you know, the Dreamer's Arcana is always this one. And yep. then they have two more that they get to pick from a list. And so... It'll depend if you have to pick those during list building or if you can pick them. Like, you sit down, you see your opponent, you go, wow, you got in a lot of... I'm playing against Signar. I'm going to take the thing where if electricity happens, I cut your face off.
Yeah. I wonder if it'll be similar to like how the Covenant runs, Mark 1 Covenant. I don't know if you remember that, where it was like a lot of situational things that happen on the board. You get extra powers because of that.
Right.
And that... It's a neat mechanic. I'm surprised that it's come...
I will say it definitely made me think that someone from Malifaux got hired from Privateer Press and they started sculpting some miniatures. That's not a bad thing because Malifaux makes some amazing miniatures, but yeah. I really got a Malifaux feel but off of that.
Everybody
of
did.
I mean, Malifaux is... And that's not bad.
Malifaux is really tied to that whole Fable correct, aspect. Correct. And you're trying to go into that aspect... It's going to look similar yeah. with pumpkins and ravens.
Right, because you're not going into Malifaux's yard, you're going into the same yard Malifaux went into, correct. Which is Fables.
It's like someone going to Cthulhu, everyone can go to Cthulhu.
Right. Correct.
Yes.
Oh, Cthulhu faction would be amazing. Oh, I would love that. Some like underwater sea-dwelling Cthulhu and yeah. War Machine. That, done.
Yeah.
I'd be sold.
Yeah. But yeah, no, so it's cool. I think
the beasts, they showed four, they only talked about three. Although after the video, the fourth one was some weird little dog-looking thing with a long tongue.
Are some of them going to be characters? Are they all just the way they were named? It just seemed I couldn't tell if they were all just general or.
I think they're general. I think
the beasts are all general. I believe.
Yeah, but I don't think there's any character beasts yet.
Yeah.
Or like ever, but they were very intriguing.
The one thing I didn't like to be so they have the guy with the cages, yep. which is really cool, and he had arcane vortex, and he was a channeler. And I believe he also, there was a third thing that he did. Oh, he upkeep spells.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So he's all about the support.
Seems different about him, though, too, because it looked like there was two different versions of him. There was ones with the actual skeletons in the cage, and then there's a different one that looked like it had pyres.
Oh, was there?
Yeah. At least in the pictures that I saw, there's ones that have like what you see in like old castles and that, people hanging in a cage. And then there's another version of it that looked like it had like a... sconces are what they're called.
I think you were confused. I know you were thinking about John Larroquette.
No, I'm yes. thinking about John
Larroquette. Oftentimes carried around censors.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, while making lots of references.
I mean, I got free speech. You can't censor me.
And then my least favorite thing about the faction so far
mm-hmm.
is that the other heavy war beast is called The Skin and Moans. And that name is the dumbest thing ever.
What?
Yep.
Oh, right. Skin and Moans. Yeah. Ooh, skin. Spooky.
Do they look amazing?
He looks amazing, and it didn't occur to me until today when somebody posted a thread about how they were going to mod this stuff. I'm just calling him Eddie. It's Eddie from Iron Maiden.
Yeah. I'm also going to mod him. I'm going to put orange fur all over him.
Oh, sure. Sure, you can do that.
He's going to be Gossamer. He's going to be wearing sneakers. He's going to have orange fur in there.
Yeah,
so. But like the model looks cool, but that name really, Skin and Moans. That's the thing, is this whole campaign, like you said, the poetry and the voice, it's like, I'm so excited about everything game-related about this faction and the models and everything, and I just could not give two fucks about the Hot Topic backwards poetry and ravens and roses and, you know, oh, here's a picture of a sad puppy in a graveyard. Ooh, it's like, shut up, give me some stats.
Like, I was just jumping on the fucking video like, I can't take it anymore.
But yeah, it's... Skin and Moans is just too edgelord.
How many... Were there more units coming than they showed?
Well, they showed, like...
They showed some Hollow Men.
They showed, what, three units off the top of my head?
There's the
pigs riding on gluttonous something, people.
Which is neat.
Which is their heavy infantry, for sure, because I think they said they had... Did those ones have snacking?
They had snacking.
Those have snacking and shield wall and impervious flesh, so they're going to be fuckers to try to kill.
Armor 5.
Then there's the Hollow Men, which is the Eyeless Sight ranged unit with recursion of some kind.
Yep.
And then there was the Pumpkinhead people that gathered corpses for other things.
Yeah, so I mean, the models are amazing. The kind of sneak peek of rules seemed really cool. I mean, I think we're going to see, like, an event with a... Well, I mean, the Convergence spike like crazy. These guys are going to spike like crazy.
Yeah.
And then people will be, and then 6 months, people are like, why does the next book have 17 things for this? I hate everything about the world.
Well, hopefully people learn their lesson from last time, right? Okay, like, maybe this time.
If there's one thing people do is learn their lessons.
Yeah, that you're right.
Well, I mean, at least this time around, people really know what Privateer means by when they say that this is a limited faction.
Yeah.
I mean, last time, people were like, oh, limited. Oh, that means I'll get maybe one thing out of the Wrath book, or maybe I'll get one thing out of the next book. No, limited means...
You ain't getting dick.
You ain't getting dick until we decide you get dick.
And that's just when we feel
then you get,
like
then
it,
you get some dick and moans. With some meowies on.
Meow.
Yeah. Apparently the brazier / sensor holding one was a
conversion. Okay. It looked like it actually had jewelry chains, so that's what I thought it was. But it's a good idea.
Oh, and neater looking Wormwood.
Yeah, I like the
spooky tree.
What they call that?
Spooky tree.
Yeah, that's basically a siren is basically what it is.
Yeah, well, it's either seduction or influence.
Yeah,
that was
a really cool model, too. Yeah. That was a very neat little thing.
Yeah, model-wise, I like all of them. I really did. I like, and the rules that they talked about all sounded pretty interesting. Gremlin swarms are confirmed to work for them. Mm-hmm. They said that minions wouldn't work for them, but that gremlin swarms, then later they said gremlin swarms would, so they must be partisan.
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting it's actually interesting because a lot of more factions, you know, you've seen a lot more jacks and beasts out there, and a lot of their stuff wants to like collect souls and attract new stuff. So it'll be interesting to see how pull out.
Yeah, you're right, because the
state
berserk,
of the game,
berserk on the one beast, the soul corpse collection on another beast, and the recursion from the Hollow Men might rely upon collecting corpses from the things you kill.
I mean, the weird thing, though, is, I mean, it really seems to really want to have a lot of infantry out there, and the way the game is kind of now, or at least it feels like in our meta, doesn't feel like it's really heavy infantry.
Sit on that until our next topic.
Which is why I kind of brought that up towards the end.
Right,
I was thinking ahead.
Well, are we towards the end here? Are we ready to segue into the other topic? I don't know. We can talk about these guys more. We can go,
what the fuck is this? We're having structure?
We're having structure.
Well, told you I was prepared. I think it look amazing, and that's all I can say.
I mean, I'm going to get the entire faction, right? I mean, I'm just for sure. Because there's three reasons. Number one, the aesthetics of it. Number two, I've run out of things to buy in the two factions I have because I already am in two limited factions. Like, I have Convergence and Minions, and they don't... You know, Convergence hasn't gotten dick all in forever, and Minions doesn't necessarily get as much as other stuff does.
At least with Minions, they finally mix the two a little bit more, where you can actually have a lot more Gators and Feral working together, which is
why
nice.
They skyrocketed to being the best faction in Horde. But I've run out of shit to buy. Like, I have Max FA, and people are like, why do you own Nis Hunters and Mark III? I'm like, because it's something that works for my faction. Like,
I plan on buying... My goal is to still go out to Lock and Load again this year. I have
two units of Nis Hunters now. I bought Nis Hunters again yesterday.
Why'd you buy another unit of Nis Hunters?
Because my Nis Hunters have been sitting on my desk at home taunting me with how terrible assembling Nis Hunters is. Mm-hmm. And I've been slowly trying to convince you to assemble Nis Hunters one more time before retirement. Come out of retirement, Andy Wick.
Well, you just...
But here's the thing. I'd have to throw like $20 at you or something, right?
Yeah.
You know? Well, guess what? Yesterday at the garage sale was... Glenn was selling a bunch of his stuff, which included assembled, pinned, and primed Nis Hunters for $20.
Oh, geez.
I'm like, so I just bought a unit of Nis Hunters, and now I'll just sell my other unit new in box to somebody.
I think that was actually something I assembled for him.
Yeah, I actually took one, and I tried to break its arm off, and I couldn't, and that's why I bought it. If I could, I would have left it there.
Did it have sword arms?
Some of them did. It was 50-50.
Okay. All right. Then it wasn't.
So it was not. Yeah, it was 50-50. Half of them had both, half had swords.
I've basically made a decision if I'm ever assembling Nis Hunters, it's without swords. Because fuck swords. Yep, you never use them anyway.
Well, yeah. Man, fuck maybe. Yeah. Maybe. Battle us those guys, get double weapon master.
Yeah, maybe.
Anyway, I currently own two units of Nis Hunters, so I need to sell the other one.
Yeah.
Aha.
Yeah. So but I'll buy them. I don't know if either of you are planning on it.
Well, but definitely, I'm not.
I mean, I'll be out there for a Lock and Load, so I mean, if you want to pass me money, I can get them for you.
I'm just hoping that running the ATC gets me infinite points so I can just have the faction.
You get 3 points.
Yeah, I won't get enough points. Well, we currently don't have a quartermaster, so it'll be awkward.
No, we have a quartermaster.
I know,
so we have
there's
three
people
of them.
Doing quartermaster duties. That was a joke.
We are funny, we tell jokes.
My three dads.
No, that's my three sons. It's my two dads that had.
No! It'd be three guys and a press gang,
and a pizza place.
My two dads.
Remember my two dads?
Oh, I remember that girl. Yeah, no, I remember that show.
What?
Yes, I had dreamed up with that girl the other day. True story.
My two dads.
What?
I had a dream up with that girl from My Two Dads the other day.
What?
Like an adult who was dating one of them, or the girl?
Well, I mean, I'm just saying. I know the show is all I'm saying.
Did the girl in My Two Dads grow up to be like super hot, like a Miss Alyssa Milano style, or?
Well, she still is hot. I mean, she was hot, and she's still hot.
I don't remember how old she was. This isn't Vicky from Small.
Well, I mean,
Wonder
I was the same age as her. I mean, so like when I was a kid,
right?
She,
like yeah, it's like Christina Ricci from Adam's Family. Yeah. I'm the same age as Christina Ricci, so it's like, not weird. Like,
Alyssa Milano, Winona Ryder, and that girl basically are my age. Oh, so
how come I don't remember the show?
What is hilarious is I watched Mermaids, a great movie that I haven't seen in forever. But the three main women in Mermaids are Cher, Winona Ryder, and Christina Ricci. And I'm like, man, if you just go in a time machine and just travel in 20-year jumps, you have three of the hottest women on the planet at each of those stops.
It is a very intriguing thing.
It's on television right now.
What is?
My Two Dads.
Okay.
You can watch...
Is John Larroquette in it?
No. I can play the My Two Dads theme music.
You could.
So, Steamroller?
What's my timestamp here, Andy?
It's about approximately 38.
So, I don't know. We're going to see all sorts of new scenarios. It seems like this is going to be a pretty big revamp.
There's only one scenario sticking around, and that's Recon. Everything else is going away.
Which is exciting. I mean, that's cool. I think it's time to get new scenarios. And they're going to be... Did they say like shapes of zones are going to be changing, like, so we're going to need to get new things?
They didn't say that shapes were changing. Hopefully they won't, because that would be annoying as fuck. But the shape's function is changing.
And the number of shapes on a board could theoretically change.
Right. So there's apparently probably going to be just more shapes in general, which makes sense why Recon is staying, because it's got five scorable things on the board.
Yeah.
Right? So it's got a decent number. Not overkill. Well, and it's got three different styles of things as well.
She's hot.
It just occurred to me that... Okay. It just occurred to me that... Oh. Hi there. Is that John Larroquette?
I guess I'm gay now.
For that John Larroquette, yes. Yes.
Topic. We were talking about Steamroller, Nathan.
Now I'm thinking about Courtney Act. Anyway, so...
I just rest him.
Okay, I'll be in my bunk. Blarg. Okay, so Recon staying does mean that objectives are staying, which is nice to know. And my guess is that objectives will stay pick-your-own style like they are in 2016,
sure.
Because that was one of the best things about 2016 versus 2015 was the pick... Or 2014, because I think it's been 2 years now.
Yeah, this is, yeah, they just been changing what they do.
But yeah, so the two big things that they talk... No, I guess there's three, right? Because there's the random turn, there's the random game end, there's how scenario victory works, and there's how zone scoring works.
Well, there's four, because there's more things per table for other tables.
I guess I would count that with the whole scenario bubble.
So yeah, so in your, so certain things can score certain zones, so only jacks control, like is it circles, or is there circle squares?
Yeah, like jacks are squares, and units are circles, and warcasters can score anything, including flags, which I guess means nothing else can score flags.
Yeah.
And so then that jumps into that. Like, if all the scenarios have a giant circle in the middle of the board, you have to bring units, right? Yeah. Or solos, at least. Because your jacks aren't scoring that ever. And
or you're just all in.
Are they allowed to contest it?
Yeah.
You know? If they can't score, but they can contest, that's one thing. But if they can't even contest that zone, then if you bring, oh, I don't know, 19 galvanizers, it means you just lose on scenario automatically.
Yeah, if only, if that'll be the interface, does the same type need to contest? Because that was, that's an unknown right
that's
now.
That's
right?
An unknown. They said only things, certain things could score each geometry, but they didn't say whether or not the other things could contest.
Okay, okay. So it'd be like warcasters in a sense, where they could score on a point, but they can never well, contest knows? A point.
Right. We don't know yet. You know, that's the thing. Like, if only infantry is even looked at inside of a circular zone, versus if only infantry can score, but anything can stop infantry from scoring. That's very, very different.
Maybe different scoring methods for infantry. Even if, you know, you. 75% of the unit is gone, well, that even, unit could possibly still score, maybe?
Even flipping around, like I'm saying, because then the question stands the other way around. If only jacks can score a square, can a trooper contest that square? Or can only a jack contest the square? Because each scenario type had one thing that could score it, and so the question across all of them will be, can the other things contest it?
And you no longer win at 5 points. You win if you have a 6-point lead.
Correct.
But you could have five. You could have like a 9
to 14 to 9, and the game keeps going.
Which is caster kill is off. I'm assuming they didn't say that. So caster kill still end game condition. So that kind of cancels out some potential control shenanigans. You can still have something in control. And then, of course, then there's the other thing. A lot of these are interesting, and they may be good or bad ideas, but everything we've mentioned so far is worth testing out and trying. Because maybe the scenarios are cool, maybe they're not. I mean, because they're going to do a whole month of playtesting on this.
Oh, yeah.
So all these coming out at the same time as the Grimkin are coming out.
And part of what... So part of the last thing that we were saving because of unhappiness... We all hate it. Well, there's two elements. One, the game ends on turn 7 no matter what now.
Sure.
Which is... which I think you need a game end. That keeps you from having...
We have a game end. We have master clocks.
Well, there is... Yes, I mean, I do think... I mean, between master clocks and each person having 60 minutes... Because really, death clock... Master Clock only came in when something wrong had to happen for Master Clock to catch. It was a catch-all. Well,
Death Clock. Like, when people were doing time turns, you needed a Master Clock.
Correct.
And it used to be either a Master Clock or Death Clock, because you don't need a Master Clock with Death Clock unless, you know, two people show up 20 minutes late to a round and you don't want everybody to have to wait for them.
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, there's the after round 5, you roll a die and a 5 plus the game ends. And round 6, you roll a die, is it a 4 plus the game ends?
I don't know about round 6. I just know 5 and 7. I'm not sure if 6 is, again, a 5 plus or if it becomes
a 4 plus. I imagine 6 has to be some sort of die roll.
It's probably a die roll. And this is whether it's the same target number.
This is not a new concept. This is something that like Warhammer Fantasy and 40K have used
for a while. Games well known for their tight rules and tournament balance.
But they have not actually, for games ending on turn 5 or so, that actually was not really used in tournaments for Warhammer Fantasy. I remember that happening in normal gameplay.
Yeah.
I don't remember that. We always ran with an actual master clock for Warhammer tournaments.
Right, and so that's the thing is, we already have master clocks, and we already... I mean, I don't understand why it exists. And it isn't justified, and people jump down his throat about this. In the thread clarifying all this stuff, Pagani said, you know, oh, well... We've done months of testing with this, and we've only had the dice roll thing come up twice in months and months and months of games, which to me means fuck it. Like, if it's that rare that it even comes up, you don't need it.
Correct.
And I bet I want to know those two games where it did come up, how much time was left on the clock anyway? Was somebody at 2 minutes and somebody's at 5 minutes and was going to end in 6 minutes tops anyway?
And that, as far as like a system, that's the best point is if something is weird and makes things odd and kind of gives a rug feel and it happens 2% of the time, just let the 2% happen and don't make some odd thing that's going to cause. Because there are enough people, the top tables, the best of the best, probably have games that under five rounds more than not.
Sure.
But I see a lot of people. I mean, there's a certain faction that there are quick rounds. I've seen more games in 2 out of months go past five rounds.
Yeah, and just because a game's over five rounds, it doesn't mean that it's a slog, that nobody's winning, that, you know, this is being ground out. It sometimes, can be an active tactical game that's still invested in both
sometimes
players.
Both sides have lost half their army, and now it's a game of inches, and both sides are just, they're maneuvering turns over, and these are fast turns, and suddenly those turns have gone 7 or 8 turns, and it's all about, you know, being manipulating the time, manipulating the board, really just trying to wait for your moment. Both players are just on edge with each other.
And those games don't need to be artificially euthanized.
The nice thing about, well, it might be just an appendix as well. It may be a suggested rule for it.
It might be the standard rule, and then the appendix says you're allowed to ignore it, you know, in which case.
I mean, I
don't want to be a Debbie Downer. I always, you know, we'll try it.
We'll give it a shot.
But not speaking personally, if it stays in, I can tell from the reaction that is out there, a lot of events will be ignoring that rule.
Mm-hmm. The whole history thing, I've played in games like that for years. I mean, not War Machine. So, I mean, it could be different in War Machine, but a lot of us have experience with that concept. It's not like a concept that we're like, oh, it's new and scary, so therefore it's bad. No, it's like, well, it's kind of sucky because I've been there. You know?
Yeah, you're about ready to countercharge somebody, some stuff into somebody, and you're like, oh, nope, it's too dark outside now.
You're going to see, basically, I thought about it a while, and what you'd see is probably more spamless, because people want the game to get drawn out, so they would do things. You'd see even, I mean, spamless are already popular enough the way it is, but you're going to see more manipulation of trying to force that in people's favor.
If I can get up on points, mm-hmm. and then make it so it takes you 5 turns to kill my army, I don't have to do anything else.
Yeah.
I don't have to get a second point. I don't have to kill any of your models. I just have to run my 17 galvanizers, get a point, and then just body block you in 5 layers. Yeah. And you murder that first layer, then you murder the second, you murder the third, you murder the fourth, and then, oh, rolled a 5, I win.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's...
I mean, obviously, that's an exaggeration.
One of the two,
you can do that.
One of the two worst versions of Steamroller was Steamroller 3, where it basically the game ended, and it usually came down to VP sniping because the way it ended. I don't even remember the details of Steamroller 3.
Well, people might not remember this, so I'll just give this back thing before we go any further. In Mark 1, models had their point cost, which mm-hmm. you know, it's still a thing that you're used to. And they also had a victory point value.
Correct.
So, you know, something might cost 35 points, but it would be worth 3 victory points when you killed it.
Yeah.
And that was a separate stat. So go on with your...
Well, and that's kind of where Steamroller 3 came in, because and the second player got to finish their entire... It's like, if you call dice down, the second player got to finish their thing. So there's all the shenanigans of just, like, you know, basically trying to win by, like, 1 victory point. It was just all these just nonsense where it was just... Because you knew what was happening, and you were able... It was all stall-less.
Well, that was where the Testament came in as king, because he would just revive all this stuff that you just got done killing. If he went second, then he just won.
Yeah, basically.
All your points that you just got off of him, he's like, oh, that's back on the table. I killed some of your
stuff. Right, because it wasn't, like, double kill. Because, like, now army points killed. If you kill a Carnivian and Thagrosh brings it back and you kill it again, you get army kill points twice. Correct.
There it was.
You looked at what's currently dead,
yep.
and you scored off of that.
Yep. Yeah, it was rough. Steamroller 3 was the king of stall lists, and I would just my concern would be we're going to see. There's a lot of good. Players already think that, you know, people that go to these spam lists do it because they know they can manipulate the time already. And then if you add the stall factor in, and you know there's X amount of turns, they're going to turn that up to 11.
So a rule that's currently in War Machine and inexplicably is slightly different in Steamroller versus the core rulebook, and I don't know why, and hopefully Steamroller 2017 just changes it, but the requirement to have your army be within 4 or 5 points of the point value that you're playing at,
mm-hmm.
people have always wondered why that rule exists, and it's because of the VPs back in the day. You could field just Butcher.
Oh, yeah.
And your opponent could not kill any point values worth of models. So as long as you could keep Butcher alive, Kane. Kane was a good example. Kane could shoot one solo and then teleport around the board and be unkillable and then win on dice down.
Because there was no kill box. Yeah, it was
also, there was no kill box, and there was no infantry for them to kill.
So it didn't
matter that you were playing 500 points down. They had 0 points they could kill.
Yeah, and that was the thing back then too. Is the sniping of points? You just kill off like one major solar, that you just run away for the entire match.
Yep.
Especially if you had a big speedy army.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we'll see. I mean, there are a lot of very interesting elements of this new version of Steamroller, and I think getting some new ideas out there is always good. But the time turns thing seems questionable at best.
Yeah.
I mean, everything else seems fascinating and worth testing out and seeing what happens and just kind of go from there and learn and adjust. And
yeah, all the things we complain about Mark I Steamroller is from what we see now in Steamroller was built off of all those complaints. It was basically, honestly, pretty much when, was it Hacksaw? Really helped
develop? Hacksaw was a big cornerstone.
Basically it was like Steamroller 209, 20.
Back when people appreciated the big organizer, the civilian organizer for Privateer.
Well, when we had a respectable one.
I know, it was nice. People were like, this guy's nice and great and awesome. You'd see him, you'd high five him, he'd be friendly.
Yep.
Back in the good old days.
There was a certain level of class to the event organizers.
There was. It used to be good stuff. Oh, well, nothing can stay perfect forever. But yeah, no, so we'll see. And I mean, like I said, even this 5-plus thing is going to leave a sour taste in people's mouths. And if it happens, even rarely, but if it's that's going to be the thing they're going to remember. They're going to remember that weird sour taste thing. And why have it even there if it's going to happen so rarely in their minds?
Yeah, although then the flip side is how rare is rarely? Because sure, they did months of playtesting and it happened twice, but how many games do they play in the playtesting? Like, if there's only a half dozen of them and they're playing 5 games a week, that's still only 15 games a week between all of them, and so that's only, you know, times 8 weeks,
and that's
100 and some games. You play that per day at War Machine Weekend.
Yeah. Some people I talked to were saying, too, some of their best memories were those, like, long, ridiculous games where it was, like, 4 miles versus 4 miles, so the game went, you know, like, 9 turns within the hour. It went within the actual a lot of time, because they still had the 60 minutes each, but it was just goofy nonsense that they were having a ton of fun with.
Well, sure, and I understand games like, I had a game in Mark I that I played against somebody, and the end of the game was literally only Kane and Gatsby 1 on the board. And both those models have teleport. So the game was never going to end.
Yeah.
Just quite literally, the game was never going to end. And so I understand at that point, you're like, well, fuck it, game's over, right? Yeah. And so this is to be there, but again,
but Death Clock
already does that. Yeah. The Master Clock in Time Turns already does that.
In today's world, now because there's two casters, and
scenarios does scenario, that.
Yep, exactly. There's all sorts of things that account for that.
There's so many things that account for it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the other good thing, though, too, is yes, they say that they've been playtesting this for the past 3 months. The cool thing about it is that this is all going into the community-driven playtesting, which I know there's a lot of people complaining, like, well, they've been playtesting this for 3 years. Well, now they're actually going to give everybody a chance to run through things.
I don't have a clip.
No, that's why it was wrapped around the top of your...
And to answer a question in the chat, they did say that Death Clock is staying. So that's not going anywhere, which, I mean, that's good, I guess, so we can keep running events with Death Clock and say, fuck the dice off.
And you know, you've paid for... $10,000 worth of Death Clocks.
Going back to Time Turn if the Death Clock would be difficult.
Oh, I don't know if I could do 200 chess clocks. Good Lord.
Not even for the sake of just the turns. Just for the sake of that, because Time Turns always had Jim was the king of Time Turns.
That's how he did it.
Yeah. You could sense when the game was going to end, and he would just jam shit into the zone.
Yeah. I mean, to be fair,
That's how you win.
I mean, I know a lot of people who, when a round started, would hit the stopwatch on their watch, and they would know, okay, you just know that if it's time turns, the minimum is 100. You know, it's between 80 minutes and 120 minutes. So once we get close to 80 minutes, I got to play. I got to change my. Right. You know, I got to adjust.
Their caster can be naked as a jaybird over there.
Yep.
And if you charge with your jack, sure, there's a 90% chance you'd kill him, but your jack instead is going to back up 2 inches and get into the zone.
Yeah.
Because just to be safe.
Yep. And that's a big thing. A lot of and many players just could never grasp the concept of that, and he definitely gave a lot of other players. I mean, I mean, Jim was the king taking advantage of it, but it was a thing that many of us would, you know, keep an eye on and play for that way. And your opponent just gets so, I just want to roll dice and have fun and do things, and you're like, well, I just want to win.
even through time turns, though, you end up losing time because, you know, as your opponent, like, okay, my time's done, and then Well, the other person's resetting up his clock.
Well, then there's the kind of like, it's you have 8 models left. You know if your opponent goes again, they're going to win, and you have 10 minutes. Now, you don't want to necessarily stall, because you can't just say, well, I'm going to wait 5 minutes, because you can get in trouble for it, but you have to, like, just, like,
Mayhem Cup, I threw a game in the semifinals.
Yeah.
I would have been at the finals table. I was against Beanish, and every other game was over, and the TO was standing behind me, glancing down at their stopwatch and up at me, and down at their stopwatch and up at me, and I had one model left. My Warcaster, who was definitely in going-to-die range of everything in his army, but it was my turn, and I was currently, like, if I just stayed where I was going to win because he had, like, nothing in the zone.
Yeah.
I clocked it over because I didn't want to be that guy.
One of the reasons I won the hardcore at Adepticon back in the day is my opponent did the exact same you did. He could, and the thing was, it wasn't like there, I mean, there was things happening, and he could have just, like, stalled 5-10 seconds here, 5-10 seconds there. Sure. But we both knew there was low on time, and he in no way even considered doing that.
Right.
But it's really easy, and a lot of competitive players do that, where it's you're not just going to say, well, I have 2 minutes, so I'm going to sit stare for 2 minutes. But I mean, like, you can fake stall pretty easily.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Or now even more. You can sit there and, like, I can measure this. I'm like, oh, man, I'm going to move a proxy. Oh,
yeah. There's all sorts of things you could just mess with people on time.
Especially now with the
you could just fuck.
Measuring.
Yep.
I need to put down all these proxy bases and do this and that. What if I go here? What if I do this?
Yep. I could have charged his jack and debated the math of boosting damage versus buying attacks. Yeah. And
Make it sound pretty good.
But you shouldn't have to have an Oscar performance in order to play in a steamroller tournament. Yeah,
exactly.
Yep.
I'm optimistic, and I'm hoping that for once it'll be true that they really play tested this thing through, or at least it'll feel like it play tested through if we have the same similar results in the community driven playtest, where we won't.
Yeah. It's just knowing that the best thing I can possibly say about that particular rule is that it won't come up often. Like, that's how bad it is that my best possible scenario is it not coming up.
God, what were you talking? Oh, that was...
You should try it to ATC. New rule. Surprise, everyone. Yeah. We're going to use it. Yeah. We're going to pull on the 5-plus rule.
There was some other rule that we were talking about. I think it was somebody's alternative scoring method for tournaments.
Yeah.
They were like, oh, you can't possibly get third.
I wish it would have added an alternate... Let me
throw this as far as running it at ATC. So... I'm going to have 60-something tables at that event running. How the motherfuck do they expect me to know every single table what round they just finished? Because I sure as hell am not looking forward to when somebody calls me over their table and says, hey, I just rolled a 5+, and this was the end of the 5th round, and their opponent says, no, this was only the 4th round. Hmm. The fuck do I do there?
I haven't had a track round since I played Warhammer Fantasy.
Which was, I have no idea how long my games are.
When it grounds down, I don't know.
No idea.
I have no idea how many rounds my games have been going, because I don't keep track. And even the 4th versus 5th, then when you're getting faster, the 6th versus the 7th, right? Like, good lord.
Yeah, I'm wondering, there might be some type of new tool that we have to invent.
That gives Muse and Broken Egg another excuse to make another device.
Yeah.
I mean, they're already literally creating rulers now. They can just create a
counter. Well, since scenarios don't go to 5 anymore, my scenario victory point counter can instead be my round counter, I guess.
Yeah.
It goes to 5. I guess after that, I just have to remember if it's 6 or 7.
What's happening? I don't know.
Go to 5, and then after the next one, slam them all back, and then after the next one, the game's over. I don't know.
Yeah.
I now hate non-Euclidean Nick with the flaming passion of 1,000 suns. He vomited up the worst idea possible. He says the controversial change would be that the first tiebreak is being fully painted.
No.
That's hilarious.
Or even sportsmanship. Sportsmanship, I am opposed to
anything that takes a external element and turns it into a victory point.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people, because the people, not only the tiebreak, but they're like, oh, if you're fully painted, you get +1 in your deployment roll. Fuck you.
Hey, you know what? Fully painted, they have a fully painted prize
that
they have in Steamroller now, and they have a sportsmanship prize in Steamroller.
And they're allowed to play in a Champions event, and they're allowed to play at Adepticon. Like, there's lots of advantages to being fully painted. A +1 to go first or a tiebreak shouldn't be one of them.
No. There's some people who just don't paint, or don't have no desire ever to paint, or maybe have no physical ability to paint.
Yeah.
You know, it exists out there.
Boom.
Yeah.
All right, so we had some topics.
That I still love you, though, Nick. Don't go away.
Yeah, don't get into a fight with him, too.
Hey, look who's talking, Mr. Man. Hey. I'm old news. You blew up on a listener on the forums.
I did.
Wowzers.
Hey.
Andy's most sensitive word. Someone's like, maybe we should do Who's the Boss anymore. I'm like, well, maybe we...
Person saying, maybe we should do Who's the Boss anymore, you'd say it like that, but that's like something like saying, well, maybe we should disembowel your child.
Like, exactly.
To Andy, that's what they said.
And make one that's better.
No, here's the thing, though.
Let's disembowel your favorite child, and then we'll just make a new one that you like better.
Here's my fairness. He didn't say... He said, let's... retire Who's the Boss and replace it with something fun. You read that as implying that the current thing wasn't fun.
Yeah, I know.
Maybe he meant something else that is also fun because Who's the Boss is currently.
I miss the old Who's the Boss. I actually like the old Who's the Boss.
There is no old Who's the
Boss. Yeah, there was
the
original Who's the Boss was you came, you brought a list. You randomly got a caster, and you played a game of War Machine, and somebody won and somebody lost.
Yeah,
they
didn't have the achievements. Yeah.
Now it's you get a caster. Sure. Now it's like, put a guy in a corner, wear a funny hat, run in a circle.
It's Age of Sigmar.
Yeah, it's Age of Sigmar. So I just, for me personally, I wanted to...
And that's fair. I mean, that's understandable. And I kind of miss old Who's the Boss. But on the other hand, somebody would roll Rasheth with Convergence, and the other person would roll God himself. Yeah. And then it's not much fun for the Rasheth guy.
Yeah, but that's why you have these respins. You got you got all the things and the things.
We could always bring back an old school Who's the Boss for the summer, and then have the charity one over.
Well, let's before we. I want to have more than like because we had it once a year. We have like 10 regular events and one Who's the Boss. Now we have 3 events. If we have like then we're going to 2 events and 2 Who's the Bosses. But eventually, then in Rick's event wasn't even a normal event, so we're gonna be like down to like. I mean, honestly, Madison was. We went competitive again. You have to run tournaments monthly.
Yeah, I apologized already to Tim. For that, what I said in my rant against him too, he may have been saying it just as a jab to me, just like a hey, buddy, jab type thing. But I didn't know him from nowhere.
Well, because I didn't know the user handle.
I didn't know the user handle at all. So, I mean, that's the problem with the user handles. You don't always know the person behind them.
I saw that post before you responded, and I was going to make a new one and say, yes, bring back spell drafts. It was actually fun. And I was like, no, I'm going to let it go. And he doesn't let things go from 30 years ago that he likes. He still clings on to. So this is something that's new he still likes. Who's the Boss? No matter what happens in the world, you're always going to push Who's the Boss.
I've always, and I mean this in the nicest way possible, I've always equated having Andy as a friend as having a second girlfriend.
Yeah, I've gotten issues.
Yeah, and he remembers what you did 4 years ago, and then he'll every once in a while just passive-aggressively mention it. Or, like, he'll do something innocuous, and it'll hurt his feelings, like you just kicked his puppy.
And I'm like, Tim
is... kicking my goddamn puppy.
And I'm like, man, Tim is going to get yelled at. I was like, poor, poor Tim.
I did feel bad the second, because I think when Tim woke up that morning and he saw all of that message, and then I got message on Facebook, I got messaged on the Privateer forums, I think, I got a personal email, and I got message on the Muse forums. He's like, duh! I'm like, oh, damn it.
Yeah, but then you edited yours to be nicer, but he quoted your original diatribe. So I read Andy's, I'm like, oh, Andy's a little grumpy. And then I scrolled down to his quote, and I'm like, oh my god! Holy shit, that is a Bill Burr sketch right there.
Yeah,
for a one-sentence comment.
hey, we should make a new fun format.
Well, he explained to me, too. It's like, I have faith that you could create something. If we were to end Who's the Boss, I'm sure you can create something that would be just as fun. And that's really what he meant there. And I took it as, fuck Who's the Boss. Fuck your baby. I want something better.
Don't fuck your baby.
Yeah.
Leave him in cars.
Yeah. Fucking Kurt from Springfield. Taking me a goddamn pictures
big
for goddamn
cool
Hot Rod
from Springfield.
Not Hot Rod, Rodimus fucking
he
Prime.
He found an actual Rodimus Prime action figure at a garage sale, bought it, and took pictures of it and tagged Andy on Facebook.
Oh, nice.
How would I say this?
While you're thinking,
out of Andy character, he got a really really nice looking toy at a garage sale for like a 30-year-old toy. That thing is in
that's like
pristine fucking condition.
Prime, yeah. And there were like three or four other Transformers. You bought a whole selection of them.
But still, fuck you and your goddamn...
Rodimus Prime.
Rodimus Prime.
You got all I see on Facebook is what Nathan posts, because Facebook refuses to let me unfollow. It's like, you will always know what Nathan is doing. So when Nathan is drunk...
You don't want to miss days like this.
Yeah. Well, that, or like Friday night when your phone was taken by someone else because you guys were all like wandering the city drunk.
Yeah. I was wondering about that.
I'm getting all these alerts.
Me and my wife, her coworker, and her coworker's deaf ex-roommate were just drunk and then wandered to a Denny's, and they stole my phone and were typing about my penis.
I wake up.
Were they all single?
My wife is not single.
Well, I know that. you should invite me.
The coworker is also not single, but she wishes she was. And her deaf friend is so very similar in appearance to you.
She has a beard?
Not she.
Oh, okay.
So, I don't think your type. I'm not going to make judgments, but he was a little more well-groomed. He had a faux hawk. He had the faux hawk going on, and then, not a really flat, not like mohawk flat, just a bit of the
John Larroquette.
Yeah, like John Larroquette. He had like John Larroquette's hair from Night Court and his beard from Arrested Development. And he had the hearing of Marley Maitland.
Good times.
Announcement, we do not sit on a couch during broadcasting. We do sit on a couch in our day-to-day lives.
I very rarely sit on a couch.
See you on a couch weekly. Every Monday when I get to your house, you are on a couch.
Well, that's the only time I'm on a couch. Okay. Nice.
Yeah, that Rodimus Prime has like all the decals on it and everything still. Yeah.
So I'm on a couch once a week waiting for anything to get to my house.
So like 100% of the time I see you at home, you're on a couch.
I am the only person that has posted sad to that picture as well.
That's because everybody loves Rodimus Prime. He's the best Prime.
No.
I mean, if it wasn't for him, Transformers would have sucked.
Now,
some would say that because of him, Transformers sucked.
No.
Yeah.
No. Yeah. I don't know. He didn't suck and die like a certain other shitty leader.
He had the touch.
Yeah. He lived.
Yeah.
Losers die. People with the touch live.
Prime's not dead.
He was. No, I didn't say he stayed. He died.
Yeah.
He died.
And then insects came, and he came back to fight the insects.
What are your feelings on Optimus Primal?
Optimus Primal, he's fine. That was before Transformers.
Beast Wars was after Transformers.
Beast Wars was great.
Well, the CGI one, like in the early 90s.
That was a really good one.
That was
amazingly...
Dinobot was amazing in that.
There's an amazing sequence of them... Because they're all about the size. I mean, Transformers are huge, the normal Transformers, but all the Beast War ones were smaller. There's an amazing sequence of them on the Ark.
Yeah.
With Prime and...
Well, because gorillas are smaller than semi-trucks, in case you've never noticed that.
Correct. But, I mean, there's a really cool sequence in those episodes with... they're on the Ark.
I don't remember that part from that movie.
In Beast Wars?
No, the part where they're on the Ark and Noah's like...
Ark I'm talking about?
Yeah, well, because they're...
Oh my god, you don't know the Ark I'm talking about.
They're rock monsters.
Two animals. One is a normal flesh and blood one, and one is a Transformer.
That's a really rough sex to make the new one.
Well, it's a half robot. Depends which one's male and one's female. Like, if the robot's male, that could be some good times for the female. You get some buzzing applications and stuff going on. Oh, and I need to... What time is it? Because we're going to put on Transformer sex as a topic here.
Yeah, but it's not good for the species.
107.
I guess the robots might have to like have.
Right. Well, so like if Noah has like
semen samples, shoves it into the robot,
and he puts in the robot, who then does that, or then he also had eggs, he puts into a robot test tube gorilla, and then the real gorilla has sex.
And it
with
makes
the robot
sense because if you only have two, then all the animals would be. That's how you don't have related animals, because if there's only two, everything will be dumbed down.
So he has one real one, and then semen samples from thousands of other ones, and so they'll all be half siblings, which really cuts down on incest.
Sorry for that lady; she's going to be busy for a while. But other than that,
maybe that's what happened is he accidentally got like two Transformer dragons, and so they couldn't procreate.
Like, no, we screwed up.
That doesn't explain how T-Rex died out, because we know there was a Transformer. Oh, well, that's the thing. There's probably two Transformer T-Rexes.
Yeah.
There's the Megatron, and Megatron didn't have a T-Rex pun name in Beast Wars, did he? He was just Megatron, but a T-Rex.
Yeah. The odd part is that they were fighting on Megatron while they were on the Ark. In Beast Wars.
So, like, they were just running around his back?
He's sitting on a chair.
And there's
the
like
Megatron, like
lap.
The classic generation one Megatron.
But he's a gun.
Yes.
Let's give him benefit of the let's give him the benefit of doubt and go to the plane version because it's bigger. Right?
That's Galvatron.
That's Galvatron, though. Right. So he's a gun that just shapeshifts? Like, how big of a gun is he?
He's a gun for Transformers. He's a big gun.
I know, but like so how could anybody else wield him?
They somehow
doesn't he transform shrink down him? To yes. let other yeah. people wield so he can shrink himself.
The best
as well.
The best part about it is generally Megatron shrinks down and goes into his most loyal second in command, Starscream, to use as a gun.
Soundwave's the best.
I never understood that.
But ignore that. So okay, even if he's let's look at Optimus Prime. So, because Megatron's probably Optimus Prime size. When they fight, they're pretty similar in size. Yeah, they're punching each other.
Yep.
So Megatron has approximately the volume of a semi.
Approximately, yeah.
T-Rexes aren't that small. Like, if you had a T-Rex standing next to a semi, so Megatron from Beast Wars is about the same size as Megatron from Transformers. Which means that if, like, Optimus Primal is small enough to fight on Megatron from a Transformer's lap, then he should just get the shit housed out of him by Megatron from Beast Wars.
We need to flowchart this out.
Right, well, like, yeah. I think I got there.
I think I need to watch Beast Wars again.
Well, in 3 weeks, we can discuss it at the ATC.
The best, also the greatest part, too, is the size changing. So, Astrotrain, he's a triple changer. Because he turns into a tank and turns into a train and into a space shuttle. In Transformers the movie, he's flying away with all the Decepticons in him.
Yeah.
Okay? Meanwhile, the Decepticons are all fighting in there because there's some of the ones that are injured. They end up tossing them out, and that's how they get turned into Galvatron and the Swoops and all those guys. But the Constructicons inside Astrotrain, the Constructicons form Devastator. If you can think of the size of Devastator as like a 60-foot-tall building inside a space shuttle.
It's a big space shuttle.
Yeah. He rumbled a little bit because of it.
He was upset.
So,
well, no, he rumbled because of Rumble and Frenzy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
you know,
they literally battering
what do battering they arms. What do they do first?
Well, that's earlier in the show. That's where they crack the shell, and then they crack the nuts inside.
Oh, and then they crack the nuts inside. Okay.
Yeah.
Zappity. We've been here for like 4 hours.
That's the best. No, we have not.
Barely over an hour, you cry, baby. And we're talking about Transformers now. That's exciting.
They're outdated.
Remember the episode of Beast Wars where...
Beast Wars is cool.
Where Optimus Primal goes full Die Hard like Commando, where it's just him alone. It's him alone inside the Decepticons base, and he just one by one murders the shit out of them. And it's just like a slasher film. Like Waspinator's just like, you know, taking a shower and gets murdered by him, and then somebody else is doing a thing and just gets murdered by him.
I don't remember this.
He's not really taking a shower, but that's the slasher movie thing. But it is. It's like he gets like caught there, and it's just one man, and he's just an unstoppable god.
Well, that also goes with the comic books, too. When Prime ended up getting captured by the Decepticons or something like that, Grimlock was left in charge of the Autobots. And one thing that not many people know about Grimlock, he's a brilliant military. Jesus Christ.
Matillery.
He is really good with Matilda. He knows all the trivia.
Yeah, but he's seen that movie tons of times.
But he's just a great strategist in that regards. So he just takes the Autobots on offensive and just almost wipes out the Decepticons when Prime's missing.
Do I have to pick up my phone too?
No, well, Arctic Circle asks if I'm sure I'm not talking about Dinobot, and I'm certain because it's either Rhinox or Primal, because Rhinox had the miniguns as his weapon.
I don't know. I've only seen like the end episode where they were about to kill, I think, Prime or Megatron in the arc. I don't know all of Beast Wars. I'm more familiar with Generation 1.
Generation 1.
Yep.
Like Pokemon Generation 1.
Yeah.
Pokemon Go added new things, in case you were...
Yeah, they did. They added a ton more. Are you starting to load up Pokemon Go again?
No, I mean I'm just in the loop.
Oh.
What happened with me was they took that happened. They took away footsteps, and I know that they apparently brought them back eventually. But I stopped playing when they didn't have footsteps, and then I just stopped caring.
Yeah.
Stopped caring. Oh yeah.
No, I'm sorry. Well, physical fitness. I mean, come on. I could just be fat forever. I'll stick with that.
For Pokemon. Oh, I yeah.
I found I walked more downtown with Pokemon Go than I would eat downtown. It didn't help. True story.
Yeah, they really, as Arctic Circle is posting, though, is Grimlock is possibly one of the smartest of the Transformers. The movies and the television show made him out to be a dumbwit, but his actual stats on the toy were fairly smart.
Yeah.
He was really more military trained than...
If you're going to have a big dinosaur, you're going to train him.
Yeah.
So do we actually have questions for people? I didn't see anything.
I didn't see much of anything either. I posted two tweets out there, but...
Two tweets.
I think I found the episode. It's Guerrilla Warfare. Scorponok tries to infect Optimus with a virus meant to change him into a coward, but it changes the gorilla into a battle-hungry maniac instead. And so then he just invades their base alone and murders the shit out of all of them.
Nice.
Good times. I watched that. So when I got home from school, I would watch that. I would watch the Beetlejuice cartoon. I would watch Batman the Animated Series. And I would watch Mighty Max. And that was a good fucking 2 hours of cartoons.
Not bad.
When I got home from school, I would watch G.I. Joe. And I think Transformers.
Well, this is a little older.
Transformers was actually in the morning most of the time.
Yeah, like when I was real young, that was the 80s stuff. This was like middle school, so like I was like 13, and I probably should, but whatever. And then when I was like, even before that, of course, was all the DuckTales, Tailspin, Gummy Bears, and Darkwing Duck.
Reboot,
yeah. Yeah, that was later, but yeah, yeah.
I remember watching a lot of Reboot.
Well, Reboot was before
Super Young Wars. Was Hasbro. Elementary school... was the Disney later than elementary, like early middle school, like sixth grade.
Like now?
Yeah, yeah. Was the Disney one. I mean, fucking Tailspin. Come on. You gotta love Tailspin. Darkwing Duck?
I was never a fan of the Duck. Anything with ducks I didn't like.
I like DuckTales.
Darkwing Duck? That was Batman the Animated Series before Batman the Animated Series.
No, I didn't like Darkwing Duck. I liked DuckTales. I did like Tailspin.
Gummy Bears?
And no, not so much Gummy Bears, but Rescue Rangers.
Pirates of Dark Water. Non-Euclidean Nick won himself back to my heart. I watched Pirates of the Dark Water. Noinja Tut.
I just couldn't get into it. I just can't relate to ducks.
You don't like Megalith?
No.
I convinced Jim to mod his Megalith to be a platypus. That way he could embrace the duck.
He's putting a beaver tail on him.
Yeah. Yep.
He's venomous. Watch out.
Yeah. And one of the only animals that can 100% provide the ingredients for custard, because you need milk and eggs.
Mm-hmm. Silence.
What did you watch instead of duck-related cartoons?
I watched just Transformers, G.I. Joe.
Transformers. Like that,
I grew up into an adult and didn't watch cartoons anymore.
Oh, I'm sorry about that. That's a
Voltron.
Shame.
I graduated to Disney films.
Yeah,
Disney.
Sure. There was a sad thing a couple of years ago. Was the first Saturday, you know, since they started, mm-hmm. that there was no Saturday morning cartoon on any broadcast network.
Yeah, but they have. I mean, for years they were just token cartoons. They haven't had like the cartoon blocks in decades that they used to have.
I watched a lot as a child of Danger Mouse.
Oh, sure.
On Nickelodeon.
Yep. Danger Mouse and Mr. Wizard I would watch before school. Those were my wake up early and watch.
I still couldn't get into rodents. Like, rodents and ducks just couldn't draw me in.
Danger Mouse is amazing. With Nero, Penfold, probably my favorite robot ever, Grovel.
Wow. I'm sorry. So what about Rescue Rangers?
Nope.
No, you didn't rub it out to Gadget and be really confused about things?
Nope.
Oh.
Or Monterey Jack.
I didn't
rub it out to Monterey
Jack. I didn't really even watch either. I guess what I switched to was like Nickelodeon's more ridiculous stuff.
Double Dare?
No, like Cat Dog and crazy shit like that.
No, Nickelodeon didn't really have like those type of cartoons.
That was late 90s. Yeah, no, I'm talking like after I got, there was a gap. There was like your Transformers, G.I. Joe, Voltron, then just nothing.
Thundercats.
He-Man. Nope, not He-Man, but not Thundercats.
Thundercats.
Never seen an episode of Thundercats.
Oh, I watched the shit out of Thundercats.
And then, like years later, like when Ren and Stimpy kind of became popular, sure.
Yeah,
kind of not.
Ren and Stimpy.
But there was a huge gap from like the and then I had
Rocket's Modern Life.
Yeah, exactly that kind of stuff. Yep. Exactly. That's when I got back into that kind of stuff.
Rocko's is very. You're very Rocko's right now, your Hawaiian styled shirt.
I mod my entire life after him.
You want to be a wallaby?
I didn't.
Really, thinly veiled sexual humor that I'm horrified at when I get older.
Yeah.
That the restaurant they ate at was the Chokey Chicken.
Yeah.
Like, I didn't even get into I liked the Animaniacs, but I didn't even watch them that much. It was more for, you know, Pinky and the Brain.
Doug was one that I brought up.
No. Yeah, no.
That's later, though.
I could not get past just the theme music from Doug. No, it's fucking.
Okay.
All right. So, anything else? That's what I got.
A lot of cartoon talk there.
Yeah.
Good old cartoon
talk. Transformers and cartoon talk.
Hooray, cartoons. I haven't found it anywhere else, but we had HBO for a little while, and it was great because I would sneak and watch episodes of Dream On because I had boobs.
Mm-hmm.
Boobs are cool. But there was a Oz.
You meant like recently you watched Dream On for the boobs.
I like boobs.
You're like,
don't judge me. But no, that's when I was younger. And there was an Oz animated series with Dorothy in there. And
I thought it was like HBO. They animated the prison show.
You mentioned HBO, an animated version of the prison show.
Yeah.
I would watch that.
Yeah. That's all,
with NBC.
That's a lot of cartoon rape. That's a lot of animated rape that they didn't really have to draw. Someone had to draw a lot of penetration.
It was the Land of Oz. I didn't say the Wizard of Oz because it took place afterwards, and so the wizard wasn't there, but it was the Further Adventures, and so it had like a lot of the later stuff. And I then also did watch Brain Games because it was on right before it. Somebody brought up Brain Games in the chat, but whatever. I watched that. But I don't think that's on Netflix or anything, so I've never seen it again since. So I only saw the first run, and I was young, and I only remember random snippets of stuff that happened in it. You know, I don't have whole episodes. I don't even have character names apart from the ones that were in the original movie, so I know them. Samurai Pizza Cats.
Very cool.
Cute.
All right, fine. We'll go on to Zappity Grumbles.
Zappity Grumbles, we have one.
Okay, what time is it? What time is it?
It's like 7:30.
I should put that closer to you so you can actually see it, so then we don't have to announce it.
We interact with each other.
I don't like interaction.
And the people listening know how long we've been talking.
Forever.
Which, when you said 107, I was confused because I'm like, holy shit, that's over an hour and a half. And then I realized that the one isn't 100 minutes.
No. It's not 107 minutes.
Anyway.
So it'd be 67.
What's our first?
Our first Zappity Grumble does not involve Brian. So thank you for having Brian participate in this Zappity Grumble.
Sure. It can involve him.
Oh, I can add to this.
Yeah, Brian will participate. Yeah.
Who is a hero you'd like to get drunk with?
Brian can participate because he's got somebody.
Never fucking meet your heroes is an important rule in life.
What? Yeah.
Never meet your fucking heroes.
Why?
Wait. Never fucking meet your heroes or never meet your fucking heroes? Because I have some fucking heroes and then I...
Never meet the heroes, fucking or not.
Whether or not they fuck things.
Correct. Regardless of who's fucking what, don't meet heroes.
Never fuck your meat heroes?
You will always be disappointed.
I was disappointed when I met Weird Al.
You're always going to be... Well, you had other things going on.
That
was
Al's fault, though.
Yeah.
It was Al's whoever Al employed's fault.
Yeah. But I'm just saying you expect so certain things...
By the chain of command.
Yeah.
Captain is responsible for his crew.
Yeah.
But,
Are we talking like superhero?
No, I think it's just like probably somebody that you would look up to.
Unless you want to get him drunk and then do things
like
to
me,
him. Inappropriate.
I would, he doesn't exist anymore, unfortunately, but I would have loved to share a drink with Lemmy.
What else? He says maybe I should have added super to the hero.
Oh, well, that's fine. Should doesn't matter.
Of. Fuck you, Jim.
But no, it doesn't matter. Lemmy. I would have loved to share a drink with Lemmy. I think that would have been entertaining. Considering he liked to share a drink with just about anybody who would want to share a drink with him, so... I don't think that would have been a bad experience at all, other than me not remembering the experience. But, there's like some other rock stars that talk about how they, when they first met Lemmy, that they tried going drink for drink with him and did not work out.
No, you can't.
You can't.
You know, you can, maybe if you want to meet your hero, maybe you should be, you know, you can always not be drinking. It's like, hey, and you're like, hey, how's it going? It's fine.
That's why I said
while you're drunk.
Or not, yeah.
That's why I said Lemmy, is because if I'm going to be drinking with somebody who I look up to, you'd want to drink with somebody who actually drinks. Drunk. You don't want to be drunk and seeing your hero. That'd be kind of stupid. I want to go drink with Superman. Of course, bad Superman was entertaining as a drunk, though.
Yeah. I like in The Flash how they have to have like super booze to get him drunk, and then he metabolizes it really quickly, so he stops being drunk like 2 seconds later.
Yeah.
Poor The Flash.
So who would you want to meet?
I don't know. So, well, wait, so now it is superheroes?
No. And whoever you want. Whatever you want. It is a hero that you look up to.
Well, they all suck.
Right. Yeah, there you go.
My heroes are all dead. I would have loved to have gotten drunk with Douglas Adams.
See, I just... What is... My brain just...
Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
My brain's always weird, because if a person's cool, alcohol shouldn't matter at all.
Yeah, well, the thing is, you want to get... I don't want to get blackout plastered, right? But there
Does he say drunk? Or does he say just drink?
I think he says get drunk. But
I think it's drunk.
Yeah, no, it's drunk with. Oh, it is drunk, so it is. So it is get hammered with. So
because there's different levels. But that's the thing. It doesn't have to be hammered. It doesn't have to be blackout drunk. There's a level of drunk where you kind of loosen up, right? And so you.
That's
you
the get part more, I hate. That's why I don't drink, because I hate that more than anything.
And that's fine, right? But you mentioned not. You mentioned wanting to remember it. And my point is, I don't want to get blackout drunk, but you want to get to the point where you are more open with the exchange of ideas. Yep. If you're going to have a conversation with this person, there's the have dinner with polite conversation, then there's the get tipsy, talk about shit, you know, and just laugh and just whatever and just like go crazy. Like, we operate at that level all the time anyway because we have no shame or dignity. But for some people, it takes a few to really loosen up and start thinking and talking and being interesting.
Yeah.
Cool.
Zappity. You didn't say who.
Hmm?
You didn't say yours.
Well, my heroes are like Jason Voorhees, and I don't think I want to hang out with him.
What if you had carte blanche that he wouldn't kill you?
Well, sure, yeah.
The two of you would just get drunk together and just stab
him. I would make an exception. I would drink with him.
It'd be a lot of pantomiming, though, from Jason, though, because I've never seen Jason speak at all.
You gotta be, you know.
Other than screaming, I'm drowning, I'm drowning.
Help!
Help! Yeah. That's about it. Otherwise, he's pretty much.
It's more of an activity event than it is anything else.
All right. Apparently, Jim wasn't happy with my answer because wanting to meet somebody isn't the same as wanting to get drunk with them. Bah. Fine. I want to get drunk with Mr. Rogers. I want to see him drunk.
You know who I want to get drunk with? That girl from My Two Dads.
Oh, you know what? I want to get drunk with John Larroquette.
Damn it.
And if it's superhero, obviously, I want to get drunk with Deadpool because he'd let me like chop his fingers off and throw them at people because he'd think it's funny.
Yeah.
Plus, maybe we'd fuck.
Those are all possibilities.
I don't even know if what superhero I want to get drunk with. It just... No.
I always think my brain is weird because people drink to relax, and the idea of relaxing off of anything offends me at such a core level. Like, whether it's drugs to relax or drinking to relax or anything artificial to relax, it's just at the core I find exceptionally offensive. And I know that's me being weird because it's acceptably norm. I mean, there's normal.
Everybody does it to some, like, there's a scale, right? And like, some people are full on none of them. Some people are like, oh, drinking's fine, but weed is evil. Like, I'll only go alcohol. Some people are like, drinking's fine, weed's fine. I'll do a little coke, but I don't want to go, you know, whatever. Like,
nobody does coke to relax.
But to have, well, to, not to relax, but
to not, function?
No, you do coke to relax the other direction, right? You do coke to liberate yourself, but you liberate it as a more energetic version instead of a less energetic version, right? Like, you do coke and you're like, yeah, let's party! Yeah. Like, that's relaxing, kind of. It's not calm relaxing, it's hyperactive relaxing, but it's to I guess relax, that isn't the right word.
But it's still an attitude to change. Cut loose. Yeah, exactly.
It's cutting loose. It's all right. De-stressing. To vent and de-stress versus to calm relax. Because, like, I'm the opposite. If I could guarantee that I wouldn't OD and I wouldn't get addicted and I wouldn't get arrested, I would do every drug on the planet that doesn't involve needles.
Yeah.
I would snort coke, I would do shrooms, I would drop tabs of LSD and ecstasy all at the same time. Fuck it. I would do it all if I didn't have to put a needle in my body and I wouldn't die, get addicted, or get arrested.
Yeah. I mean, that's fair, and I think a lot of people would.
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, if you want to be happy, you know, just, you know, natural high, people.
just enjoy.
You're going to talk about enjoying life and being happy.
Hey, I'm happy almost one day a year for at least 10 minutes. And it's just like people when they're drunk, they're happy and they're got. I mean, at 10 minutes a year, randomly, it's usually like 3 PM, and I'm just at some random place. I'm like, oh, I'm happy enough. No, it's gone. You know, it's never an aptitude. It's never been like a time just right.
Right.
But
if Coke could get you up to 12 minutes a year.
Well, to be fair, if the Coke comes with hookers, I'm in for that. That's a deal. Well, that's sure. That's a double thing. I would
blackjack.
Know. Yeah. Ask, you know. Leave the blackjack at home. But otherwise, yeah. It is disturbing. I mean, coming from me, it makes no sense because I don't understand happiness, but I want to achieve it. I want to relax naturally, not artificially. And I never do reach that point. So maybe
it's time to try the other thing. Maybe your method isn't working, Brian.
Maybe it's time to
become an alcoholic.
Yeah. I mean, it's always on a docket.
Right.
It's always like...
I mean, the thing is, though, you don't have to be an alcoholic. I mean, that's...
I would not part-time drink.
That's not what Mo says. The only person I know who aspired to be an alcoholic. Like, he was putting in the effort to become one. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm not naturally an alcoholic, so I just need to drink constantly and pretend to be one. What?
All right.
Zappity.
Does anybody in chat have a zappity grumble? Because that's it.
They had something about living in Jeremy's brain, but Jeremy's had some sad stuff happen recently, so his brain right now, it is a sad place, and our hearts go out to Jeremy.
Yeah, everyone is... Yeah, definitely. And that's one of the reasons why you haven't seen Jeremy on the podcast for a while. He's been dealing with some very strenuous family issues.
Yeah.
So, yeah. So unfortunately,
prayers for Jeremy.
Yeah, unfortunately, those had come to a close yesterday.
Anyway.
But anyway.
Anyway, Zappity?
Zappity Grumble. We're done with those. All right. Recommendations?
I saw Lego Batman.
I saw
Lego Batman.
Yay!
We all saw Lego Batman.
I liked Lego Batman. I will also follow up.
It was probably the best DC film I've seen in recent years.
Yes, in recent years for sure.
Yeah.
It's not the best DC film. It's not the best animated DC film. It's probably in my top... It's for sure in my top four.
There was just enough humor to make me laugh most of the time, and plenty of good comments to enjoy in the second viewing.
Yep. There's a lot of throwback comments in that, well, sure. Which is
when
amazing.
He lists like 50 villains, and they get more and more ridiculous, and then they make a joke about, you know, these are all real. Look it up. I sadly recognized every goddamn one of them, and I knew the powers that, like, you know, the polka dot guy. Like, I know the polka dot guy. I've read issues with him fighting Spider-Man.
Well, I mean, first of all.
It was a crossover with DC and Marvel. All
right.
Spider-Man punched him in the chest and went in one polka dot, and his own fist came out the polka dot in the guy's face and punched Spider-Man in his own face.
Nice. I wasn't sure if you were just trying to troll there or not. So.
The Convent King, is it?
Yeah.
Well, some of those guys are also in Gotham, because Gotham is so out of touch with who to pick for villains. Right. That they, you know.
Brian didn't see it, but I saw it, though. There was a nice shot of all the prison cells. In there, and the Convict King is just spraying his window with ketchup and mustard everywhere.
I was so sad that Clayface was made out of Lego. I know it's a Lego movie, but if he had been like Play-Doh, like actually, if they had gotten a Claymation Clayface and walked him around, I would have kind of loved that. But holy shit, finally, after being the first ever on-screen appearance of the character, they brought back Billy Dee Williams to play Harvey Dent / Two-Face.
Yeah.
And that's awesome.
Yeah, overall, it was a very entertaining film.
Yeah, I'm talking about Spot. Yep, Spot.
Sure. Yeah, they did a good job. It was a good job. Bane was funny.
Yep. One thing I liked about the movie a lot was it would have been easy to just do a Batman movie and film it in Lego and be like, man, Lego Batman, give us all your money. And we would have, right? You know, here's all our money and we'll go buy the Lego toys and whatever. But it mattered. They justified it being in Lego. Like, it mattered. There were scenes where they master build stuff. You know, this building's blowing up. Well, now you don't have buildings anymore. You have chunks of Lego and you can use those chunks of Lego to build whatever you want. And so they build a plane out of it because you can do that.
Only a one-seater, though.
Sure, only because he only got one butt. But he does that several times, and even stuff like the climax, how they resolve the final disaster, only works because they live in a world made out of Lego.
Correct.
Yeah.
And I was very impressed from a filmmaking standpoint that they justified that as being a core part of the movie instead of just being, it's made out of Legos.
Yeah. No, yeah. And they're pretty aware in that regard.
The Lego movie was like that. Yeah. But yeah. I was worried this wouldn't.
Yeah. No, exactly. They could have just like gone off in a different direction. Yeah. But they seem to really be embracing that level of nonsense.
The new one that's coming out.
The Ninja one
looks... I was unsure of the first trailers I saw of it. But the trailer I saw right before Lego Batman made me go, yep, I want to see this.
Yeah.
Like, my father. What'd you call it? What'd you say? Like, no, I didn't say anything.
Yeah, that was good stuff. It was very hilarious.
Yeah, and somebody doesn't know their movies because the Kraken was in it. Mm-hmm. And they were like, I don't know why they had to knock off Godzilla if they couldn't get the real Godzilla.
Oh, yeah, it was the Kraken from Clash of the Titans. Yeah. Actually, I honestly didn't think of it as the Kraken until you mentioned it. Now I'm like, no, yep, that's perfectly the Kraken. I was like, why does Godzilla have six arms? I don't understand this. I didn't realize it was the Kraken.
I was like, that's not Godzilla. And so I was thinking maybe it was Gorgo, but that would be super obscure as far as kaiju, because Gorgo is not exactly the most commonly recognized kaiju ever. But then when I saw the tentacles, I'm like, oh, it's a fucking Kraken. That's great.
I did have an issue with the film.
Was it Ralph Fiennes voicing the wrong character?
Nope.
Okay.
Who did he voice?
He voiced Alfred, which is fine, but you know who else he should have voiced? Fucking Voldemort.
Oh,
yeah. He played Voldemort. And so you have Ralph Fiennes in a movie with Voldemort, and you don't go, oh, hey, you want to just do these lines?
Oh, man, that makes sense now. No, when they had the fucking gremlins, and it was raining.
Well...
The gremlins were on the bat wing, and it was raining at the time. There should have just been a whole plethora of gremlins after that.
As they fall off the plane?
Yeah. And I would have been fine with it. Spitting out more gremlins. Well,
then they fall into the Gotham Bay? Exactly.
Of course, it was more lava than anything, so that would have ended that problem pretty quickly.
Yeah.
I love the beginning, the MacGuffin jet and the whole...
Yes, the fact that it was MacGuffin Airlines. MacGuffin is... The Wilhelm scream is mainstream enough now that everybody and their mother recognizes the Wilhelm screams. So the MacGuffin is my new favorite thing that's just barely mainstream enough that they use it, knowing that not enough people will recognize it.
And the inside bar at the theater, though, is called MacGuffin's.
Yeah, I know. They're MacGuffins. The Sam and Max cartoon, speaking of cartoons we watched when I was younger, there was an entire episode where their favorite breakfast treat, which was glazed MacGuffins, stopped being produced, so they went on a journey to get the MacGuffins. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, no, there's some good stuff. And I enjoyed the movie quite a bit. I laughed a lot.
And, of course, the whole gay love subplot that was not veiled in the slightest. The entire movie is literally a love story between Batman and Joker.
Kind of. No, he was disappointed.
He likes to fight around. He doesn't fight one person exclusively. Yeah. I like to fight several people, and you know.
I don't think it was a love triangle thing. I would think it was just more of
like, I hate you instead of I love you.
Yeah.
The whole scene where he has to say that. Oh, you too.
No, because it was set as a villain hero perspective. I don't think it was set as a gay thing.
I don't. You're always looking for the gayness in these movies.
I'm not saying that they were gay. I'm saying that it was intentionally written as if you take that exact same dialogue and replace the word fight with sex and hate with love, and you have a romantic movie.
I don't see it either.
Fuck both of you. You are trolling me.
No, I'm not trolling you. I don't see it that way.
You keep thinking Frodo and Sam are gay because...
No!
Can't people just be friends?
You are trolling me, you assholes, and I'm biting it because there's no way you're this thick.
I love how they laugh at the romantic comedies, by the way. They watch them, and then they're always just laughing at them, and that's the best.
I think it's only one clip that they got of Will Arnett laughing.
Yeah.
Just replay it.
Yeah.
There's so many little moments in that movie I can't even remember because there were so many.
Yeah, it's definitely something I'll have to watch a second time, because especially with the shots of all the criminals in the pods, where there's got to be more stuff
in there. They had good use of music for like flashbacks, that good Batman music, good Superman music. They really like pulled back to the old stuff as far as that goes, too.
I want to watch slow motion when they talk about all the older movies and that, and then that troublesome time in the 60s.
Yeah.
We're going to hit people so hard, words are going to appear.
Well, and apart from the 60 flashback, all the other ones they had Lego style, but just making the iconic shots, and so those would all be good like posters.
I would love to see. Well, I'd love to see just an animated version of those in Lego.
The nipples.
Yeah.
Shut up, Joel.
Oh my God, can you imagine like seeing Batman and Robin in Lego style? I think it would actually be entertaining.
Yeah. Maybe.
Especially if it didn't take itself seriously like this movie.
Fucking Batman and Robin.
It's a bad movie. I remember being in the theater seeing when they besides having the credit cards, I remember when Batgirl found out about Batman and Robin, because they had a video screen that was showing the exact beginning of the movie of Batman and Robin.
Yeah.
It's like the scene in Spaceballs when they watch it, put in the video of themselves, watching themselves.
It's not a good movie.
No. I mean,
so bad.
Batman Forever is passable. It's a passable film.
It is what it is. You know, it's glitzy. It's got the neon. It's over the top. I understand it's all that on purpose, but he did it too far in Batman and Robin.
He did it so far in Batman and Robin, actually hurts Batman Forever.
Yes.
It has backward damage.
Yeah, that is true. Like, if Batman and Robin hadn't come out, I could have respected Batman Forever a lot more as just being a different style. Now it's like, oh, it's another Joel Schumacher Batman. Exactly. Shit.
Yeah.
It's all like, right. I still think Matrix 2 is tolerable. Matrix 3 is so bad, it makes 2 suck more. A questionable film just becomes worse because of the next one.
The stuff not involving Neo is actually really good.
That's the thing. Like, the Burly Brawl is bad. And, you know, like, at the time, I was like, oh, it's him fighting 1,000 Agent Smiths. It's so cool. It's boring as shit.
I don't mind it in 2 because it's a one-time thing, but when 3 is just that again and again and again, I don't like it.
Yeah.
Like, 2 is salvageable.
Yeah.
You know, 2, you cut out the 45 minutes of him in a room talking to a guy with TVs.
Yes, that's like a problem.
You cut that shit out. And then the Burly Brawl, what I wish they had done, and it's just so obvious to me how you make that. You need drama, right? There has to be drama. You can't just go, and then they punch for 15 minutes and it's cool, and then the scene ends. And that's what Burly Brawl is. They punch for 15 minutes and then the scene ends for no reason. The whole concept of Agent Smith of the agents in general is that they inhabit bodies. Right? Mm-hmm. So you look at Matrix 1, he takes over this hobo, you shoot the guy in the head, he turns back into a hobo, you just murdered a hobo. You did it in a circuitous method, but you murdered that fucking hobo. So if Burly Brawl, he's fighting and he's killing and he looks around and he sees dozens of women and children dead because he's killing them, so Neo has to retreat because he's being forced into being a serial killer.
That's what makes 3 so worse, because basically the entire planet is right. Him. So basically the whole planet's been, all of mankind's destroyed because of Agent Smith. There's so much
possible
problems.
Drama there, though. Yeah. You know, you can make the entire fucking movie, because then Neo can't just murder all the enemies because he's murdering all the people, and so then he has to hamstring himself.
Has to find out basically where the core of Agent Smith is so he can actually eliminate the code.
The core. How can he drive him out as opposed to killing the host body? You know, an exorcism. Then you get a drama. Then you get a plot line instead of just bad CGI for 10 minutes and then it's over and there's no reason for the scene to have existed.
I don't mind that scene. What you said is a better thing.
The issue with it is that the test I always do with scenes like that, whenever you have an action scene in an action movie, well, really any scene in any movie, but with action scenes, it's usually the easiest time to do it, is say, if that scene had not happened. Like, if I just go and I just cut out that scene, make no changes to dialogue or plot, would anything change? And the answer is no.
I don't know. I mean, I watch Shoot 'Em Up, and I watch it constantly, and that movie.
But the scenes don't matter.
Well, I mean,
the plot is driven by the scenes. In Burly Brawl, he's walking down a street, he gets to an alley, he fights Smith for 10 minutes, and then he walks away from the Smith.
I forget how that scene ends is my big thing.
They just walk away.
He's like, I gotta go.
Yeah, they just leave.
Yeah,
I don't remember.
There's nothing gained. There's none of them. Neither of them steals an item from the other. Nobody else dies. Nothing's discovered. They literally show up, fight, and then leave.
Well, the important thing from that scene is that every person in that scene that worked with Keanu got a motorcycle.
He bought
all of something. And that was those people who helped film that movie helped probably people with John Wick, some of the
the stunt people directed.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's the other important thing with that scene is it gave us John Wick. So that's
you're
why
right. Burly Brown's Boulder. So
there was no Burly, there would be no John Wick.
The Smaug chase scene in Hobbit 2.
Yeah.
What amazing movie is going to come out of that?
Yeah. Yeah, that movie hurt me.
That fucking scene.
How do you make a dragon suck?
Like, really? How do you make a dragon fighting people boring?
Yeah.
Yeah. Like,
At least when you text the city, the third one, that's the least interesting.
Thoramir standing on his nose.
Yeah. Ooh. Yeah.
Wow. Yeah.
Fuck the Hobbit movies.
Zappy. So recommendations?
Well, Lego Batman.
We all gave Lego Batman.
Lego Batman. I was going to re-recommend... I played Star Wars Rebellion again today, and I just want to re-recommend that game. It's such a fun two-player game.
It only costs you $1,000 a year to play it.
No, the Rebellion, the Fantasy Flight.
We only played that once, and you never played me again, I think, because you were scared.
You fucked me over so hard in that game.
That is true.
Why don't I get
to you? I can't think of a person more not the demographic target for this game. If I could divide the people up, Twilight Struggle.
Quick aside, not Twilight Imperium.
But the Twilight Struggle is more like...
Yeah. Kemet, that game you have and never play with us and that we all like.
Yeah.
The expansion for it was in the make an offer pile at Pegasus yesterday.
Oh, son of a bitch.
I'm sure that the make an offer still stands, is why I'm telling you. Wander down to Pegasus and say, hey,
I didn't see a make an offer, there wasn't any piles.
You know how there were four fucking boxes full of brand new board games sitting in front of the terrain room? I wandered in at 3:55. I'm like, what are these boxes? And Steve was like, yeah, that's make an offer. Nobody's made any offers. I'm like, maybe because they didn't know that all the boxed up games in your storeroom were for sale.
We walked by and we saw all those. Yeah. We were looking at them going like, what is this?
And yeah, they had Elysium and they had made...
There was no... I mean, that seems 100% a Steve move.
That pile... The point is... Yes, that was... Those turns out those were all make an offer. So the point is, if you go to Pegasus and say, hey, I didn't realize that was a make an offer pile. Can I buy that expansion? I'll give you, you know... half retail, you know, here's $20, whatever, I'm sure they'd let you have it.
And then go play Star Wars Rebellion.
And then fucking play Kemet with me with the expansion, because we all enjoyed it the one time we played it, you dickhead.
Well, you want to play it one or two more times without the expansion than go to the expansion.
Sure, maybe, whatever. But Star Wars Rebellion's good for anybody but you.
Yes.
Okay, so
we're going to play a three to four hour game.
Yeah.
And
it's just me against you.
It's a two-player four-hour game.
Okay.
And single mistakes can crush you later.
But you won't find out until 4 hours later.
Well, yeah, you'll kind of see it coming a little bit.
For example, maybe when you start the game, you know where your hidden base is, and you want to put your fleet next to one of... Brian's got three medium-sized fleets, and you know that if you spread your fleet out into three small fleets, his medium fleets will all crush your small fleets. Mm-hmm. So you want to put all of your fleet in one spot as a large fleet to attack one of Brian's fleets first thing, to cripple it, to then kind of hopefully be able to dictate where combat is. But Brian talks you out of that, and it turns out later on he's like, yeah, like the only way that would have been a good thing to do was if you were going to attack me right away. And that was your plan, but because he talked you out of it, all your
fleets get destroyed. It was your very first game, you to be assumed fair. That was dumb. It was your first game. I played the game a few times, and I've seen Rebel players throw away their models early when you do something bad with your fleet early. You're really screwed. And even if you attack, I know how fast the players build. It's a risk move that if it works is great.
Yep.
But I just don't want someone in their first game to do some crazy thing.
Also, don't sabotage Mon Calamari.
Correct. Do not sabotage Mon Calamari.
Why would you?
The rebels are allowed to cripple planets.
Sure.
And because usually the Empire has all these planets, and the rebels are like, fuck this planet, and so it cripples it. And the Empire's like, oh no, my planet's crippled.
They have cards to fix it.
Yeah, the Empire can fix the crippling. You know who can't fix the crippling?
Oh.
The rebels. So you drive the Empire off the planet, you take the planet back, and you're like, well, this place fucking sucks.
You broke it.
Forever.
It's all filled with squid.
Forever.
Yeah.
So that happened to me.
No. I would like to... I know we had a video of a game going for it, and unfortunately I ended up losing audio from it.
Yeah.
I would like to re-record it again.
What game?
We had Ryan Beal came over and we had talked about the game. I wanted to do some board game things. Yeah. I've since given up on that.
Because of me.
Because of Andy.
We don't have the battle reports coming out like we said we were going to do again and stuff like that. And well,
just need to schedule a recording for a battle report.
It's a lot of time.
You would need to bring the camera to every Wednesday to record somebody, get a pledge from them to come to your house and record the thing. You know, it's work.
Yeah.
But I don't know.
But yeah, no, Rebellion's fun.
You would have to start with a smaller scale. Excuse me. You would have to start with like a Bioshock Infinite Siege of Columbia before you could work your way up to a Star Wars Rebellion or a War of the Ring.
But yeah, I'm going to like put some effort to try to get
maybe two-player games in a month. I think that's a reasonable... I want that number to be higher than two, but I think with everything else going on, with as many game nights they have going on, getting in two games, and I'm trying to rotate between War of the Ring and Rebellion. I'm actually getting rid of my Battle Lord, Battle of Westeros, only because I have
too many two-player games. Decent amount of money for that.
Yeah.
You got all this mansion shit. I am shocked that for all these fucking topics, Lego Batman and board games and Star Wars and stuff, we have had zero chat.
Yeah.
I mean, they've moved
they're
on.
They're too engrossed. Like, Travis left.
Travis is like, they don't like everything in Steamroller 2017, so I'm out because everything Privateer does is great, and if they don't agree, they're dumb and left.
Rocky Eagle N7 posted some smiley with a dick for a nose and tiny chatting. Slant eyes. A little. Look at that. They have like two lines about Lego Batman and nothing about board games. Man.
Yeah, guys. Talk about board games.
Quick, make somebody a mod.
All right.
Everyone's in charge.
But yeah. Andy, did you have a recommendation that wasn't Lego Batman or Star Wars?
No, I recommend Lego Batman.
I beat you to it, though.
So we all kind of recommend Lego Batman, and I just had this add on to the Rebellion.
Yeah.
Hooray us.
Woohoo! Being a short podcast, this is not a short podcast.
No, it's not.
Yeah, we had a lot to talk about. We got there, guys.
We did.
90 minutes. That's 30 minutes per person. That's how you pace yourself.
Pace yourself before you pace yourself. What?
All right. I'm going to stop this train.
Bye.
You've said bye-bye.
Bye, John Larroquette.
You should replace... Quick, Andy, stop time. Replace all those guys' heads with John Larroquette heads so that the people watching right now see John Larroquette instead of...
Hi, I'm John Larroquette. My name is John Larroquette. Hey, I'm John Larroquette.
I was on Night Court. Rawr. That's my John Larroquette impression. He's a dinosaur, apparently, in my head.